This episode is brought to you by Progressive Insurance. Whether you love true crime or comedy, celebrity interviews or news, you call the shots on what's in your podcast queue. And guess what? Now you can call them on your auto insurance too with the Name Your Price tool from Progressive. It works just the way it sounds. You tell Progressive how much you want to pay for car insurance, and they'll show you coverage options that fit your budget. Get your quote today at Progressive.com to join the over 28 million drivers who trust Progressive. Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and Affiliates. Price and coverage match limited by state law.
You're working from home. You settle in with a cup of coffee, ready to get the day started. Before you look at that to-do list, turn on your favorite Odyssey sports station on your smart speaker. We'll keep you company and bring you the latest updates from your teams while you tackle your inbox or get ready for another meeting that probably could have been an email. Power through the workday with the entertaining sports coverage you love from the local voices you trust. Just ask your smart speaker to play your favorite station.
Hey, what's the easiest way to find out what channel the game's on? Sports on What? Subscribe to the Sports on What app and quickly find the channel for every provider, satellite, cable, or streaming. Sports on What knows the channel the game is on, and you can too. Download today.
And now, here's the question.
Hola, bitches. Good day to you and yours. All right, I mean, let's be honest, all right? I've forgotten to lock up the house before, both before I went to bed, after I've left for work, but thankfully nothing bad happened. Forgotten to lock the car door on several occasions and found out each and every time after noticing that someone had rummaged through the car. Lost a pocket change, a pair of sunglasses. Not the end of the world. And it could always be worse. Like a guy that works at a zoo in Nigeria, he forgot to lock a lion's cage. And he did not realize that until he went to feed the lion. Now, the good news is he did successfully feed the lion because he became the lion's meal. In front of guest. Not a good scene. And inevitably, no matter what happened, someone has to go there and clean that mess up. Now, I don't envy anyone who has that job, but at least you understand what your job entails, if that is, in fact, your job. In Long Island, a local handyman, he got a call from a local resident asking for his professional cleaning help. The job was to help clean up a murder scene. Now, the main problem was that it was not the police who called him. It was the murderer himself. And as you would hope, our handyman turned down the offer and called the cops instead. And while I'm not a cop, I think I'd rather get that call than the cops in Idaho. They got a call from two paranoid guys. They called the police because they thought they were being followed in their vehicle by police. And they were worried about that because they had 20 pounds of weed illegally in their car. Well, it turns out they were not being followed by police, but after alerting police to the fact that they were worried about the police following them with all the weed in the car, yeah, the police pulled them over and arrested them. Ta-da! Now, these are just some of the stories we've seen, stories that left us with many questions. Questions we'd like to ask you in the form of our random question, and this is how it works. You call us, we'll ask you a question at complete random, and after you share your story, we will share with you the news story that inspired said question.
To be a part of the Big Show, the random question, call 206-803-ROCK. Like the Men's Room on Facebook, follow us on Twitter and Instagram at Men's Room Live, and send your emails to themensroom@kisw.com.
This episode is brought to you by Progressive Insurance. Whether you love true crime or comedy, celebrity interviews or news, you call the shots on what's in your podcast queue. And guess what? Now you can call them on your auto insurance, too, with the Name Your Price tool from Progressive. It works just the way it sounds. You tell Progressive how much you want to pay for car insurance, and they'll show you coverage options that fit your budget. Get your quote today at Progressive.com to join the over 28 million drivers who trust Progressive. Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and Affiliates. Price and coverage match limited by state law.
You're working from home. You settle in with a cup of coffee, ready to get the day started. Before you look at that to-do list, turn on your favorite Odyssey sports station on your smart speaker. We'll keep you company and bring you the latest updates from your teams while you tackle your inbox or get ready for another meeting that probably could have been an email. Power through the workday with the entertaining sports coverage you love from the local voices you trust. Just ask your smart speaker to play your favorite station.
Miles and Thrill, 99.9. KISW.
Hold the chills, away we go. Welcome to season 19, episode number 4,190. What a large and in charge program we have for you today. Guaranteed future repeat. The exciting return of your guess is as good as mine. Our categories. just out today from our friends at Wallet Hub. The best foodie cities in America. If you are a foodie, these are the best places you can go. Now, do you guys consider yourselves, I mean, we all love food, but are we foodies in this room?
It depends how pretentious you are about what you think you know about what you're eating. To me, determines a foodie versus someone who knows what they're talking about. This is just my personal experience.
Okay.
These people are foodies. This guy's a foodie. This person's a foodie. And it's like, all right, you like what you like, but you never share anything groundbreaking, and you overpay for slop.
Right.
That, to me, defines a foodie.
So, no.
Okay.
We all like food. We all like to cook food. But I don't. Yeah, I wouldn't. I wouldn't label anybody.
Also, foodies tend to go to the restaurants before anybody else. Mm-hmm. If something's opening that's supposedly going to be acclaimed, they will get there within the first 2 weeks and eat.
Is it super small portions that are overpriced, and if they're happy about it, you're a foodie.
Yeah, then they'll blog about it, or they'll do their social media stuff about it. But ultimately, typically, doesn't it take a restaurant at least a month just to kind of just settle in and get their feet wet a little bit?
At least.
So,
at least.
To me, it's like, like, give them a chance for a little bit and then go there once things settle down.
The service wasn't good. Well, they're fresh. They're new.
Right. Yeah.
They're figuring out the operation, dumbass.
I feel like a foodie menu is one sheet.
One sheet was printed that day.
Which is not the worst thing in the world because, you do a few things, but you do it well, hopefully. Mm-hmm. All those dishes are done well. You don't have too much on the menu, but trust me, I know it sounds somewhat ridiculous, but there is something rather gratifying to me about going to, Cheesecake Factory, and there's 17 pages of stuff I got to go through because there's so much
food. And all of them are good.
Yeah, I mean, I like the minimalist aspect. I also like, I can get anything I want in this joint.
I would say I think that's the other difference, too, between people that just like food and calling yourself a foodie.
Yes.
Is that we're honest, and, sometimes, right?
You want your Southwest egg rolls, bro.
Yeah.
Because you like the taste, and you can explain why you like the taste.
28 metrics. Data set ranges from the cost of groceries, the affordability and accessibility of high-quality restaurants, number of food festivals per capita, which we seem to do pretty well here in the Pacific Northwest. I mean, you would never know it, but there's a seafood festival going on in Ballard every year. There's all kinds of different food festivals out
there. Salmon Fest is pretty good.
Greek festival over the weekend, all kinds of great Greek food and everything else. So, yeah, we have I guess barbecue is one we miss.
There was a big barbecue one down in Enum Claw this weekend.
There was. Okay. So those are all the metrics on the 10 best foodie cities in the United States of America. Next up, I wonder why we picked this one. We have the top 10 Seahawks of all time.
All time.
Offense, defense, special teams. But what players they say stand out as the best in franchise history? They had a bunch of writers who cover the Seahawks give their recommendations, and they narrowed it down to the 10 best players to ever wear the Seahawk uniform. You got a wide receiver in there. You got a cornerback.
A blitz.
A defensive end. A couple of safeties. A running back. A linebacker. A defensive tackle. An offensive tackle. One quarterback also makes the list as far as the top 10 Seahawks of all time. So if you pick that category.
Nostalgia or statistics?
I believe a little bit of both.
As far as the quarterback.
There's only one that has the Super Bowl.
Right. That's what I'm saying. So is it your stats or is it your nostalgia? Because it's two very different things in that case.
Yep, that's fact. So those are your categories coming up with your guess. It's as good as mine. The top 10 Seattle Seahawks of all times and the best cities for foodies. I'll also give you some new locations on the Men's Room IPA. Thank you for continuing to email us. Let us know where you're finding the beer. I know a lot of people have found it at different locations from the stadiums. The Key Arena.
Somewhere on the... where did BD go this weekend?
He went to Whidbey.
Okay, Whidbey. I found your beer at the little shop that they have there. He did not say he bought any, but he did point out that he saw it there.
Orcas Island.
All right. Orcas, that is an untapped area, man.
Did you guys just hear him shout from down the hall?
What was he shouting?
I think he was shouting Orcas.
Yeah, and Orcas, right. That's a lot farther, completely different. Finding it there, I'd be fired up.
Yeah, that's what
there's a ton of stuff in Whidbey Island. And it's much closer. You got to go to Whidbey Island just to get out to Orcas.
But do us a favor. Right. If you happen to see the beer on tap or in your favorite watering hole, convenience store, grocery store, send us a picture of where you see the bright yellow can, and we will hopefully continue to update that list to KISW.com. We heard last week the beer's now on over 16?
13 was last 13. I heard, but it keeps growing is the thing. So it was 13. At that point last week, but then we happen to know that coming up sooner or later, a bunch more locations are going to start. It's unbelievable.
No,
but and it's funny, though, because I love the fact that people all over the state, they found it here and there, but we get the listeners from out of state, nothing. We have our guys in New York, upstate New York.
Oh, yeah.
And they have the guy that, I think, did he drive out here? And I don't know. Either way, they buy our beer when they come here. We're only here for a couple of days. Load it up in their trunk and then drive 3,000 miles back to upstate New York.
Yep.
To drink a 12-pack.
And thank you because it helps our three local Fisher houses. So just know that. Whenever you buy the San Juan salsa, the Men's Room Roasted Red Salsa from San Juan Salsa Company, or you pick up a beer broad from Uli's Famous Sausage, a portion of that proceeds go to our friends locally at the three Fisher House locations. Also with the Men's Room Beer Broad, that's got the Men's Room IPA from Black Raven on the inside of the sausage.
And Miles finally had it, and he can attest, it is delicious.
And I've got three more pounds in my freezer, and I'm just waiting for that moment to...
the moment. What needs that? There's Monday Night Football tonight. Each Sunday, of course, is more Thursday Night Football.
Weekends work better for me on those types.
I thought you might have fired some up. Yesterday, you had your Ravens in primetime.
I did, and that's why I made a pound of steamed shrimp with Old Bay on it, because it was the Ravens.
Did you eat during the game?
At the beginning of it.
Yeah. Okay, my wife was making dinner, and before I could even say anything, she's like, I will make it for halftime. Because me and my son, we're going to watch this Ravens game. And we're down in the basement. She made us go to the basement because we're very loud. So we went down to the basement to watch the game. As she said, I can hear you clear as day. But sure enough, at halftime, dinner was ready. We both finished eating before the game came on. I can't eat and watch the Ravens at the same time.
Also, just a little programming note for you. We, as of yesterday, are 2 weeks away from the KISW first ever Halloween Hullabaloo, starring Godsmack and Hailstorm. That is Sunday night, Showware Center on October 13th down in Kent. We do understand the tickets, if there are some left.
If there are.
There are a few. And when we announced this show, I was like, This is in October. Like,
when did we first, March, April, or something?
And the summer's just gone. It flew by. Like, for whatever reason, this year just flew by. But we're already here, man. It is the first big Halloween party of the year.
Mm-hmm.
We encourage you to come in costume. Have a good time with us. That is a great price on a ticket for a fantastic night of bands. So there's four bands all together, Warning and Flat Black, also playing along with Hailstorm and Godsmack. So if you are thinking about going to that show, do yourself a favor. Head to KISW.com right now and get yourself a ticket. How many of us
there?
And join us there. And today is the day we do our random question, 206-803-ROCK.
We're
random,
checking our phones. Random, I apologize. Random, just hit us with the random. Hit us with the random, Miles.
A lot of phone issues today.
It's Monday. It is Monday. I don't know if it resets over the weekend. I don't know anything that happens here over the weekend, but...
Well, plus Verizon was just kind of down today.
Yeah, so... Were they down? Because the thing is, my cell phone, I'm on Verizon. I have not had anything wrong with my phone.
Oh, you did?
I did not.
Mine was like on SOS for a while.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay, because I read something this morning and it said, if you're reading this headline, you're not a Verizon customer. And I thought, because I am. Just not through cable. But my phone was okay. Maybe.
I think it's fine now. There was definitely an outage earlier.
Yep. Oh, okay. I knew nothing about that.
You know, I don't
Maybe
mind.
I'm the outage, man.
I don't mind that. You know, I just...
It does not bug me.
It's not my fault. Network was down. I was unattainable.
Sorry.
3 or 4 hours. Was it that important? Let me ask you this. What would you do if I was dead?
Mm-hmm.
Do that. If you have a question or any advice, just like, think if I'm gone, do what you would do then. How's that?
I've said that to my wife
To
before.
My kids.
What would you do if you couldn't reach me? Like, just do that.
Do that. You know?
Because you know my response is, I don't know.
Yeah, what were you going to do? Do that then. Yes. All right, let's go.
I'm trying to think. What do I do if Miles is dead?
Mm-hmm.
Well, after we're done dancing.
Throw a whole huge party. What?
Raid his house.
Right. Take all my food out of my freezer, have a big barbecue.
What's in your freezer? What's in your freezer that I don't want? I know you got
3 pounds of bedroom sausage.
Yeah, I know that.
Yeah.
But you do like a lot of salmon. I don't like cooked salmon.
I do scallops. I do shrimp.
I'll take that. I do
seafood. I probably have like 6 pieces of fish in there right now.
What kind of fish are we talking?
Halibut, sole, which is basically black cod.
Don't you like how that works?
Regular
sole is black cod. I'm just saying.
I never thought
about it.
I like salmon. Yeah, sole, brother.
Yeah. Black cod. You know, sole.
But it's S-O-L. You know,
I think after the funeral and stuff, frankly, I would try to take your trip to Africa.
You could do that. Because I can't. Yeah. I can't cancel it, I don't think.
Yeah. Transfer it over.
Sure.
Hey, man, he died. Can I transfer the stuff over? Go on safari with your daughter.
You got to dress like a grain of sand. But other than that, you know, you need some sand.
That's a good call. Sure. Taking your trip to Africa, sorry.
Yeah.
I'll take the black cod. You take a trip to Africa.
Mm-hmm. I got some curtains, you know, whatever you need. All right, let's see here.
Your vinyl collection. You probably have most of it.
I might, but I'm still snatching it up.
You bought your car used, right? Is it paid off?
Oh, yeah.
I'm taking the car.
Yeah, man.
All right, can you drive the vinyl to
my
place?
How about that in 2006?
Yeah, I'll drive the vinyl over, and Mike, you get his golf club.
I bought that car in 2016 for $32,000, man. It was like, you know, just a used car, trucks along, no problem. All right, let's go with this random question. What did you guys forget to do? And I'll start. My mother's birthday was on September the 6th of this month, and I believe the date was the 16th. When it dawned on me that I had forgotten her birthday.
It was at least two business weeks.
And needed to call her. That is correct, because I was thinking about, oh, no, I know my dad's birthday is in the middle of September. So I went and I looked, and when I looked at my phone, I saw another dot on September 6th, which means, like, Amazon package arrived. Right. Yom Kippur, whatever the holiday is, whatever.
Yom Kippur.
All they give every holiday, you name it around the world, my iPhone tells me every single one. Half the time, I'm like, what is this day? I have no clue. But the dot was there, mom's birthday. And I went, ah, God. So I did call my mom.
But how do you broach that? Because it's one thing, like, I've called my mother the day after, and you say, Mom, I forgot. And they go, dude, we get it. It's now the next day. You are 2 weeks later.
That's right.
I mean, this is like, were you in a coma?
I said, what did you do? And she said, I went up and saw your sister and your brother in Pittsburgh. And we went to your niece's volleyball game. We had two lovely dinners. We went out, and we also cooked in for one meal. And we had a wonderful weekend, and then I drove home. And I relaxed, and good thing your grandma was okay while I was gone for the 2 days. And I said, that sounds like a lovely weekend. I'm sorry I forgot the whole thing, but I did.
I told you I forgot my brother's once. I shouldn't really say forgot. I'd gone out with some friends.
It's almost worse.
Yeah, this was years ago, right? And I ran with, say it. Fancier fast crowd.
Okay.
So yeah, like a limo. There used to be nightclubs that we went to in Seattle. We partied all night, have like an after hours. So that Saturday is my brother's birthday. We sleep in real late, wake up hungover, and it's like, let's just get food, start ripping beers, and watch college football. And we're having a blast. And then Sunday I get up and I'm like, oh my God, I never texted my brother.
Mm-hmm.
And that was
just send the text.
That was a quick phone call the next day, you know, me trying to apologize, and he's just like, it's fine. I get it. We'll talk next week.
Yeah.
I'm like, it's fine.
That's fine. Pretty much what it was.
Yeah, so it's not fine.
A few days later it was okay, but I don't blame him. He was pissed. He had a right to be.
I always forget to pack one thing. It's kind of my specialty move. Mm-hmm. So I'll get someplace. I'm there for 2 or 3 days, and I'll think to myself, I don't have socks.
Right.
Or there's no toothbrush. I must have put that back in the drawer. I'm no deodorant. I've done that one before, where I, like, you know, I'm gone for 3 or 4 days, have no deodorant, or forget my toothbrush. I forget just something that is kind of essential to day-to-day life.
Sure. But at least it's cheap. A thing I think I forget most often, and it's not the end of the world, it just annoys me. I try to do a good job and make myself lunch before I come into work. And the last thing I do before I walk out of the house is do that, right? I creature a habit, do the same thing, same order every day, and man, like, I'm on I-5, I'm halfway here, and it's like,
damn it!
God! Ah! And it's just the fact, it's sitting in a bag that's all packaged up.
Oh, yeah. It's probably not going to be good tomorrow, either.
Well, no, the bigger issue is, my son and I have very similar tastes, so the way my son perceives it is, oh, well, you know, I'm home from school, and Dad left this here, clearly, must be for him. So I'll get home and be like, Dad, that sandwich was great. I'm like, uh-huh. And the orange soda, good looking out. I'm like, that wasn't good for you.
Out. Good looking.
That was not for good you, man.
Raise your ass. What did you forget to do?
I don't blame him,
but it's annoying.
Right. I live alone, but if I got home and there was magically just a homemade cold cut and orange soda, I'm eating it.
Well, the thing is, when the kids, this sounds really bad, but if you're a parent, you know this to be true. The kids are already at school. So now when you're making food for you, you take a little extra time of care.
Yeah.
Right? Because I don't have to negotiate what you don't want to eat and all this crap. So, like, I'm hooking myself up, man. And then dude gets home and it's like, dude, that sandwich was great.
Reason why I asked you, what did you forget to do? This is a completely challenging story. I'm going to try to get through it, though. A zookeeper has been mauled to death by a lion in southwestern Nigeria after he failed to secure the locks on the enclosure when he went to feed it. According to police, 35-year-old man worked at the Presidential Library Wildlife Park, owned by former Nigerian president.
Good luck.
Olusegun Obasanjo in Abeokuta.
Dude, capital, if you're going to be the king of Sierra Leone, you've really got to nail these
Ogun
names.
Ogun State. Local police spokesperson Omolola Odutola
said in a statement that the lion inflicted serious fatal injuries to the man's neck. He said the lion was then shot to release its grip on the handler. According to the statement from the Ulusugun Obasanjo Presidential Library, the zookeeper had taken some guests to see the lion feeding routine after hours on Saturday evening. He apparently, feeling comfortable with the animal, left the safety protection gate open and proceeded to feed the animal. He was mauled by the animal and died on the spot. To prevent further mutilation of the body, the animal was put down by the personnel of the park. The victim has been named as Babajai Dalyu, described by police as a trained lion handler.
Is he?
It comes less than 1 year after another zookeeper was attacked and killed by a lion at the Obafemi Awolowo University, also in southwestern Nigeria.
Like butter. Like butter.
Thank you.
And he did this in front of guests. Yeah. I mean, these are buddies of his. Hey, man, we'll see how we do this. And like, oh, that's how lions
eat. He didn't say you're going to feed him you. More of the random question coming up, 206-803-ROCK.
KISW. The shenanigans continue. This is the Men's Room with Miles and Thrill.
Random question, 206-803-ROCK.
Hello, Emmett. Random, welcome random, to the Men's random, Room. Random. Hello, Emmett.
It doesn't sound like anybody's there.
Hold on.
Hang on.
Hello.
Emmett.
Hola.
Oh, hey. Okay.
He must have messed it up.
Yeah.
Emmett, welcome to the program. Random question. Let's go with this one. How did you try to raise some extra cash? How did you try to make some extra money?
How did I try to raise some extra cash?
Or, make some on the side.
You ever deliver papers? My brother did that. You did that too.
I've done that a little bit. I've done some some landscaping. I've done some yard work. I'm a mechanic. I can weld. I've done a whole bunch of different stuff, you know, for friends or for, you know, somebody that just needs something. I have a few things that I do every once in a while if I ever need a little bit of extra cash.
I definitely enjoy help people landscape.
I don't mind helping
people landscape. There's just a sense of accomplishment when you're done.
I think there's a difference, though. I don't mind helping people landscape because I'm not a professional landscaper, right? But you are a mechanic. So at what point do you charge me as your friend, right? Because I would imagine if you're a mechanic or if you're an electrician or a plumber, your buddies call you all the time. Hey, man, I got this little thing going on. But there has to be something like, look, I'll do this for you, but I want some money.
For me, it entirely depends. Generally, if it's a project that, like, I would charge somebody, I will just, you know, I will just say to F off, depending upon what it is. If it's something simple, like, you know, like one of the last things I did, my buddy needed a turbo on his truck, and it just so happened I had a turbo for that specific truck laying around, and I was like, I don't really have anything else going on today, so I just swapped it out for him.
Nice. All right. See, typically I would say, like, look, man, I'll pay for the parts, and then I'll pay you for your time.
Right.
However you want me to pay for it, in cash, in beer, in whatever you need.
Pizza, sure.
Weed, you know. I mean, I'll find a way to pay you back. Just you tell me how you want it.
And I'm curious to know, when you delivered papers, were you on a bike, on foot, or in a vehicle?
When I did what, sorry?
Delivered papers.
I didn't say I delivered papers.
Oh, I thought
Miles
you said
asked him if he did.
All right.
I did one summer with my brother.
Were you guys vehicle?
He would kind of, there's so many houses that, like, he had a car, but basically he would just kind of drive the car and I would just walk along and chuck them.
Yeah, my brother did. He walked. I never delivered papers personally, but he had the, it's called the old woman shopping cart. You know, the one you fold up in your own garage. Load him up with papers. He'd walk up and down the street, get attacked by dogs, and deliver papers.
Mm-hmm. I'll tell you what, one of the funner ones I had, it doesn't seem like it, but when I was first starting out in radio, I was 15, 16 years old, and the radio station I worked at, they had a crew that would go out and do local dances.
Mm-hmm.
So if it was like a high school dance, if it was a wedding, any kind of party, they were available as a DJ unit. And I know you worked for Chip for a while.
Yeah, we did
bar mitzvahs,
weddings, bar mitzvahs, bat mitzvahs. We did a couple graduations.
But it was, you know, for the most part, there were some events that were a little bit stuffy, so to
sure,
speak.
Sure.
I mean, no offense to Mike, he stepped out of the room, but a couple of auctions were boring as hell. But as far as the weddings go and the parties and, like, the high school dances and all that, man, I mean,
when I was 15 years old, I was not in high school yet. Our high school started when we were sophomores.
Okay.
So we had a three-year high school instead of a four-year high school. So to go to a high school dance.
Oh, yeah.
With all of these girls.
You're a DJ.
If you're still high school age, that's awesome.
Yes. To go to a wedding where a bottle of something might end up in a case that we need to bring back to the radio station or whatever the deal. You always got fed.
Mm-hmm.
Just like endless sodas. The whole night people are coming up to you asking you if you could help put on a request or whatever the deal is. And I thought that was great. Out till 2 o'clock in the morning. Parents didn't care because I was working.
Because you're working.
Yeah. So it was a good way to make some side cash. And typically, the guys I was working for, they would just pay me out of their pocket in cash.
Oh, yeah. They got
just to help load in, load out.
That's what I did with
them. And I just took the money.
I'll tell you what, the bar mitzvahs were always, to me, one way or the other. It was either, like, super strict and, like, the mom and dad had the songs they wanted the exact time. Like, do not talk.
Right.
Blah, blah, blah. Or it was the other side where it was like super loose. It's saying, I mean, I was over 21 and people were like, you want a beer? Like, is that all right? They're like, we don't care.
Yeah.
Like, we're just having a giant party. But there was never like in between.
Right.
Those. It was either super strict or super loose.
Raise me ass, how did you raise some extra cash? A couple in Arkansas was arrested after they allegedly attempted to sell their 2-month-old baby for a 6-pack of beer.
Oh, Jesus.
And a $1,000 cashier's check. Darian Urban.
Who do you approach for that? Even if you're thinking, all right, man, let's sell the kid for get a 6-pack and $1,000. Like, who looks like they might take that deal?
Well, Darian Urban, who's 21, and Shalene Ellers, who's 20, the baby's parents, they're arrested on the 21st of this month after the manager of a campground in Benton County contacted the local sheriff's department, and that's in Arkansas, for an incident involving the couple. Person said the couple had written a letter granting custody of their baby to Cody Martin in exchange for money. The letter included a disclaimer saying, there will be no change in y'all's two minds and to never contact us again.
Sounds official.
That is a, that's a contract. Responding troopers found the baby needed medical attention and called emergency medical services, who took the infant to a local hospital for evaluation. Child, by the way, thank God, is now in the care of the Arkansas Department of Human Services. Multiple witnesses corroborated the attempted adoption. Deputy also reportedly obtained a cell phone video of Urban and Ellers signing the contract with a man trying to purchase the baby. So they filmed it.
Oh, my God. So someone, was this person setting them up, or he was actually going to buy a baby for $1,000 on a 6-pack?
It's a little weird. Witnesses reported that a resident of the campground identified in the affidavit as Ricky Crawford. I know what you're thinking. A Ricky in Arkansas. Yes, it happened. Had earlier in the day visited Urban and Ellers and offered to take the baby for the night. Just in exchange for several cans of beer. So he was just going to take the baby for the night and take care of the kid, all right? But they came back with a contract and says, hey, look, you want the baby, you give us $1,000 and a 6-pack of beer, and we'll take the baby. You can have the baby.
So it sounds like maybe Ricky here was trying to be nice, just like, I'll give you a night off.
Yeah,
and they're
sure.
Like, take our baby.
Ricky, who apparently by the report of the trooper, heavily intoxicated, confirmed that he had taken the baby from the couple and brought the infant to a friend. Another witness told authorities they smelled a strong ammonia and fecal odor coming from the baby. The baby had a soiled diaper, and the diaper rash was so severe, they needed to document that and take the baby in. According to the affidavit, Martin told detectives that he spoke to Ellers about the reason for the potential adoption, and she said, it just not working having three dogs and a baby. Which means the dogs are more important.
Yeah.
Court documents say that Martin told detectives he drafted the agreement for Urban and Ellers to sign, but clarified that no money was exchanged at that time. He said he would arrange for a cashier's check for $1,000, but the couple never received that payment either way. They have already been released on $5,000 bond. Ellers remains in custody, the mom, on $30,000 bail, but the father of the group is out.
Someone's got to watch the dogs, Miles.
That's crazy.
Hello, Breck. Welcome to the men's room.
Hola, gentlemen.
Hola.
Breck, welcome to the program. Random question. Since we're talking about kids, let's do this question right here. What did you discover or find when you were a kid?
I was always messing around in places I shouldn't. Let me think about that one for a minute. How did I find when I was a kid?
Sometimes you don't even realize what you found as a kid. You know, because I remember finding roach clips and little incense cones.
Mm-hmm.
My brother just thought they were weird that they were packaged together. Because I'd seen my father use the clips, you know, on electric stuff. We couldn't figure it out. And then just the day happens where you get older and you say, oh, okay, I see where you kept your weed.
Right. I discovered a crawl space underneath our porch. And so anything that I had that I wanted to make sure that was just in my mind safekeeping, mm-hmm. I put there. I put it in a shoebox. I use that area sometimes as like a cool little fort.
There you go.
You know, where I could take
what
my flashlight.
What kinds of important things did you have at that age that you needed to protect from other people?
Just things that I thought were valuable.
Baseball cards, army men.
Right. I learned very quickly not to put any kind of candy in there because the ants would get yeah. to it or an animal yeah. would go in there and drag it out. But anything I just did not want my parents to know I had or anything I just wanted for myself that yeah. I thought was of importance at the time. So I had a lot of my action figures down there. I would bring like my, I don't know, I kept my sleeping bag in there just because I thought it'd be cool to have my own little fort. But it was just a small little door, and I never really realized what was behind it until I worked the latch when I was about 4 or 5 years old. And so when I worked the latch and got in there, it was like stuff that the old homeowner had had.
Yeah.
No one had ever crawled in there. I mean, even, you know, we'd been in there for a couple of years, but no one had been in there. It was all just old stuff. I kind of cleared the place out, made room for myself, and I kind of thought I had this cool little fort.
I mean, at that age, you did.
You know. Let's see. Reason we asked, what did you discover or find as a kid? This is a weird one. Leave it to curious preschoolers to spy something odd in the supermarket that escapes everyone else's notice. UPI reports that Danielle Morales was shopping with her two boys, 3-year-old Zachary and 4-year-old Parker, at Market 32 in Clifton Park, New York.
Oh.
When what do kids do? They want to stop by and check out the lobster tank, which is a favorite from just about anybody. But
I'll do it now.
If you're a youngster, you know, and Parker goes, hey, Mom, that one is blue. Wow. And I thought the mom said, wow, that's kind of weird. So Morales said she took a quick pic, then contacted the aquarium on her phone using Facebook. Now, after confirming the lobster was indeed a special specimen, Morales strolled back to the counter and told the guys, hey, I just want to let you know, the aquarium's going to call you. Don't sell that one. You right. do not want to sell that one. Lobsters typically appear blue or other colors like orange or white due to genetic anomalies. In the lobster's case, however, experts believe the darker blue color may be caused by its diet. Either way, the aquarium took custody of the lobster, placed it in quarantine, as is customary before joining other aquarium residents. It will be placed in a communal tank sometime next month. As for its name, Morales' boy dubbed the hard-shelled creature Bluey, after the cartoon
okay.
character.
All right.
But when they were told the lobster was male, they changed the name to Bandit. That is the name of Bluey's dad.
Oh, yeah.
Is Bluey female?
So it was a 3-year-old and a 4-year-old that like said, hey, Mom, look, that lobster's blue. She takes a picture, sends it to the aquarium. The aquarium is there that afternoon.
Damn.
To take that lobster out of the tank because it's a special specimen and saved its life.
Do you charge the aquarium for the lobster?
Yes.
I mean, I would.
I would, yeah.
Do you charge more or do you charge whatever the rate? Because the aquarium could say, look, man, it says $7.99 a pound. Like, what is this crap you're trying to say? We're going to pay the price that
was
you
have.
Was
it a big supermarket or like a mom and pop shop?
It says Market 32 in Clifton Park. I don't know. We just read a story about a month ago about, I don't know if it was an employee of a Red Lobster. Same
oh,
thing.
Yeah.
They had like, it was like in the middle of Iowa or some crap like that. And they're like, hey, man, that one's blue. And
right, I remember that.
Next thing you know, that thing is gone.
Random,
how do you
random,
miss that
random,
Red Lobster? Random,
the one blue lobster?
Random, yes.
Yeah,
random,
I don't know.
You know, I coached a baseball all-star team once at Clifton Park, New York.
Random, oh, really? Random,
yeah.
You see any blue lobsters?
Nah, did not.
You're not living. Hello, Robert. Welcome to the men's room.
Hey, folks. First off, I'd like to say thank you for helping me keep my sanity in this afternoon traffic for the several years. I appreciate you guys, and I appreciate what you do.
Oh, well, thank you, man.
We appreciate you, man.
Yeah, we've been contracted by WashDOT to prevent people from losing their mind. Because yeah. they said, look, we're not going to do it, so maybe you guys can help us out.
Since you are out
Robert,
there
Robert, can
the
I call you when I'm stuck in traffic? I could use a little relief.
Yeah.
All right, since you brought up traffic, I'll give you a different one. Do you think, honestly, that you are a good driver? Because some people who know they're good drivers, other people think they're good drivers and not. Some people know they're just not very good at it.
Mm-hmm.
So where would you put yourself in the category?
So I tell my wife this. I am a great driver, defensive, always looking, knowing. I've sat in traffic so long, I've almost witnessed everything. So
I put myself in a very good driving category.
Who are you scared to be in the car with that you know? Friends, family?
If they're driving.
Yes, correct.
So right now, I'm a little scared with my wife's daughter. I'm teaching her how to drive. And she comes in hot.
meaning, what do you mean? She drives a little too fast?
Well, meaning that the brake should be applied a little quicker.
All right.
We're almost going to rear-end it.
Okay. And does she have her permit?
Yeah. Yep. She's 20 years old, so she doesn't like the testing part of it, so I'm trying to get her used to everything so it'll be a breeze for
her. So did she just wait a little bit longer because she was hesitant to learn how to drive? It wasn't important to her, or was she just scared of the whole process?
Yeah, no, she's got a little anxiety, but she just really didn't need it, and I don't think she understands what the freedom you get when you get a car, you know?
Sure.
I
will tell you, man, I was one of those kids. I didn't get my license until I was 18. And I wasn't scared of driving. I just didn't care to.
Right? But also, like, where we lived, it wasn't necessary to get anywhere. If you want to get somewhere, it was easy. You know, you walk there, subway there, you name it.
Hey, Robert, you'll love this one. My daughter, or my niece, she is 15, but she can get her permit. And she'll be 16 here pretty soon. So she has been adamant. My brother wants her to get her license. First of all, because she does all these different volleyball tournaments, all these different games, practices. It's just, it would take a little bit of load off him and his wife as far as just being on the road all the time. And they're encouraging her to learn how to drive. She wants absolutely nothing to do about getting behind the wheel. But guess what happened last weekend? Last weekend, she was invited to go to homecoming with a boy that she always liked, but she didn't know that he liked her.
He liked her, yeah.
Now, she is foot on the gas, man. I want to drive. Yeah. Give me a car. I need some freedom. I mean, this is in a week. In a week.
Yeah. Yeah.
One incident.
Did you tell your brother that means she's getting laid?
Yeah. I tested almost on my birthday. I wanted out.
Oh, me too. I did the same exact thing. As soon as I could get it, man, because just based on where we lived, it was...
Sure.
If you wanted to go someplace and have fun, you had to drive.
I mean, I think most people are that way. Mm-hmm. But Thurl's right, like, between using the metro, and then I just had so many friends that, like, already drove and stuff. Like, I don't know. It just wasn't a huge thing for me to go get a license. Even to this day, right? Like, I drive, but if I don't have to, I won't.
Right. Well, the thing with us was we had friends that had cars. And we had friends whose parents paid for gas, did the insurance thing, any kind of mechanical issue. Or there were our group of kids and friends that, man, that required us to get a part-time job.
Yeah.
Immediately. Absolutely. In high school. If we wanted that car just for gas money, and that was the deal. Hey, look, man, if you and your buddy are going to go downtown, I need a dollar. I need 50 cents.
Oh, you definitely had to pay to get in.
Yeah, I've gone to the pump before and put in $1.50 in gas. Just based on the fact that that's what we have, but that would get us downtown, get us home.
But it was driving, it was parties. Like, look, we can make this happen. But everyone that says, yes, I want to ride with you, gas money, bro. Right. And it didn't matter if you had 75 cents, fine. Just got to sit in the back seat. You got a full, crisp $5 bill. You're riding shotgun.
Sure. And you learned how to change your oil. You learned how to change filters, brakes, all those things. I definitely remember the fact that I had to change my oil all the time, but it didn't really matter because my car burned so much oil. I just kept it in the back seat of my car and continued to pour it in because it would just burn off on its own. Anyway.
I think that is absolutely part of the process.
Yes.
Well, I will say, also, back in the day, like we're talking, like nobody had cell phones, right?
Mm-hmm.
So the biggest issue I ever had not having a license as like a junior or till I was 18 was that sometimes you'd go to a party and maybe spend the night, but the dude that took you has gone morning.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and it's just like, oh, Christ, now I got to figure out a way to get home.
A lot of times, just a long walk.
The reason we asked you think you're a good driver, a new survey asked people from 50 states to assess their own driving habits. They didn't just ask an overall grade. They asked people if they were guilty of 19 different bad driving habits.
What does everybody in here think?
As far as being a good driver?
I'm all right.
I'm good.
I mean, I don't think anybody else would consider me to be a good driver. I'm an efficient driver.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think that's the best way to put it.
I use my signals. I do all those things that are supposed to be good, but I get there faster than my friends.
Miles, I have rode in the car with you. You're a good driver. Ted, you've rode in the car. I've rode in the car with you. You're a good driver. Am I a good driver?
Yeah.
All right.
Miles is the only one that kind of scares me.
Yeah.
I mean, I've never seen you get in an accident or nothing. It is fast and aggressive.
Yes, it is. A new survey asked the 50 state people to assess their own driving habits. These are things like speeding,
under 10 miles per hour, over or extreme speeding, eating and driving, texting and driving, not using your turn signals, road rage, tailgating, running red lights, hell, you know you live in
the
Seattle
area. I'm good
at
all those things.
You've seen all this crap.
I sell it all of those.
89% of drivers in Hawaii consider themselves to be good drivers. That sounds pretty good. It's actually the lowest among all states.
89%. Oh, some bubbles must be burst.
Yeah. Hawaii has the self-professed worst driving habits at 89%. Oregon is the second worst state, followed by New Mexico, Wyoming, Alaska, North Dakota, Connecticut, Vermont.
Where people don't live.
Kansas and West Virginia.
You're going to speed. You can do what you want. You're not going to hit anything.
Most all states admitted to the top three bad behaviors. Speeding, eating while driving, and speeding through a yellow light. Oklahoma was the only state where admitted that texting and driving made the top three worst habits. Drivers in Tennessee say they are the least worst drivers. Chevy drivers are the most likely to admit bad driving habits, followed by GMC, Buick, Chrysler, and Dodge drivers.
All right.
There you go. More of the Random Question coming up, 206-803-ROCK.
What's up? It's your boy, the Ted Smith from the Men's Room. And did you know I have a podcast? Well, I do. The Podcast. New episodes uploaded every Wednesday on the Odyssey app.
This episode is brought to you by Progressive Insurance. Whether you love true crime or comedy, celebrity interviews or news, you call the shots on what's in your podcast queue. And guess what? Now you can call them on your auto insurance too with the Name Your Price tool from Progressive. It works just the way it sounds. You tell Progressive how much you want to pay for car insurance and they'll show you coverage options that fit your budget. Get your quote today at Progressive.com to join the over 28 million drivers who trust Progressive. Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and Affiliates. Price and coverage match limited by state law. This episode is brought to you by Progressive Insurance. Whether you love true crime or comedy, celebrity interviews or news, you call the shots on what's in your podcast queue. And guess what? Now you can call them on your auto insurance too with the Name Your Price tool from Progressive. It works just the way it sounds. You tell Progressive how much you want to pay for car insurance, and they'll show you coverage options that fit your budget. Get your quote today at Progressive.com to join the over 28 million drivers who trust Progressive. Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and Affiliates. Price and coverage match limited by state law.
You're working from home. You settle in with a cup of coffee, ready to get the day started. Before you look at that to-do list, turn on your favorite Odyssey sports station on your smart speaker. We'll keep you company and bring you the latest updates from your teams while you tackle your inbox or get ready for another meeting that probably could have been an email. Power through the workday with the entertaining sports coverage you love from the local voices you trust. Just ask your smart speaker to play your favorite station.
This episode is brought to you by Progressive Insurance. Whether you love true crime or comedy, celebrity interviews or news, you call the shots on what's in your podcast queue. And guess what? Now you can call them on your auto insurance too with the Name Your Price tool from Progressive. It works just the way it sounds. You tell Progressive how much you want to pay for car insurance and they'll show you coverage options that fit your budget. Get your quote today at Progressive.com to join the over 28 million drivers who trust Progressive. Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and Affiliates. Price and coverage match limited by state law.
You're working from home. You settle in with a cup of coffee, ready to get the day started. Before you look at that to-do list, turn on your favorite Odyssey sports station on your smart speaker. We'll keep you company and bring you the latest updates from your teams while you tackle your inbox or get ready for another meeting that probably could have been an email. Power through the workday with the entertaining sports coverage you love from the local voices you trust. Just ask your smart speaker to play your favorite station.
Hey, what's the easiest way to find out what channel the game's on?
Sports on What? Subscribe to the Sports on What app and quickly find the channel for every provider, satellite, cable, or streaming. Sports on What knows the channel the game is on, and you can too. Download today.
9.9 KISW. We return to the Men's Room with Miles and Thrill.
It is a Random Question. Question 206-803-ROCK.
Hello, Cheyenne. Welcome random, to the Men's
random,
Room.
Random, 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 random.
Hola, gentlemen.
Hola.
Cheyenne, welcome to the program. Random Question. Question. I got one just for you.
Okay.
What could you not believe that you came home to, either as a child, adult, with roommates?
Mm-hmm.
What could you not believe that you came home to?
Probably
coming home to about 30 college kids in my dorm room that had been in my apartment. They were in the middle of going streaking, and I was at Evergreen in Olympia. So.
Okay.
And you had no idea that they were waiting for you?
No. They asked me to watch their clothes on the way out.
Okay. So they began the process at your place.
Yes, they did.
And did they come back and get their clothes, or did they just run home?
No, I mean they did. I was tempted to lock them out, but then the larger side of me, or the better side of me, decided not to. So,
I think you should have locked them out at least for 20 minutes. Does that sweat a little bit?
Yeah, I came home on time to a buddy that was couch surfing and his girlfriend, and they had just come back from North Carolina, and the girl was 19 years old. I think Timmy was 19 years old, maybe 20 at the time. But the girl's parents did not approve over this relationship. The fact that she was supposed to go to college and ended up moving to North Carolina with Tim, who got a job like at Sam's Club or whatever the deal was.
Are they the kind of couple that would have tried to sell their baby for $1,000 and a six-pack?
Well, they came back with their dog. They didn't have a place to live. I guess he got fired from the job. But they were crashing at our place. And at that time, this is like 1989, their parents had no way of getting hold of either one of the parties. They knew they had come back to town. They did not know where they were. So when word got around that they were staying with us, her mother found out about this. And when I came home, she was there in our home screaming at her daughter and Timmy, who were in the living room, which was where they were now camped out for, like, they'd probably been there for a month and a half.
Oh, God.
The dog is there. She's trying to drag her adult-age daughter out of the house. It gets to the point where now she threatens them to go get the dad. Apparently, the dad must have been a badass, because even Tim was a little bit freaked out by the whole matter. Because I guess the type of guy he was a little bit more volatile. And I know she, based on her demeanor, I could tell that the last thing that she wanted was her dad showing up at this residency. And that was what her mother kept threatening her with.
Right.
I'm going to go get your dad. And I just assumed that that meant, you know, all hell was going to break loose. I did eventually meet that dude. He was like 5'5", 5'6". Mm-hmm. He must have just been a badass.
Sure.
Because I was expecting this mountain of a man that would just come and crush you with his bare hand. But he's just like this little scrawny guy, but apparently he was a badass.
And
he just beat the hell out of people. But she eventually drug her out. God bless her.
How long did this take from the time you got home?
About 2.5 hours.
Oh, my God.
To finally,
and what do you do? Just like go in your room or...
Well,
hang out in the living room and listen, go out and grab lunch.
It was just really uncomfortable, and we kept telling Timmy he needed to leave anyway. Like, you've been there long enough, you have not paid any bills. Like, every day, you sit on that couch, you guys watch TV, you know, he kept complaining about not being able to find a job. And we're like, Tim,
you gotta look to find
you gotta get off the couch to find a job. You know, he just didn't understand the concept.
Well, you know, typically, you just go get a job.
Yeah.
That's exactly it.
Go get a job. Reason we asked,
there was one guy when I lived in a house in Baltimore. He lived with us only for like 2 or 3 months.
Mm-hmm.
But that was always his same thing. And it was like, no, you don't do anything.
Right. You're not looking for, they don't just call you at random to see if you would like a job.
And at a certain age, too, like, to me, just late teenage years, early 20s, like, you're not going to find a dream job. You just need a job.
Job, yes.
Get some dream money.
Yeah. Reason we asked, what could you not believe you come home to? There's a new show that follows the life of the self-professed, quote, Dolly Parton of chimpanzees. She is apparently a blonde, as they describe her, cosmetic surgery fan who works for an exotic breeder caring for 7 apes at a primate foundation. So she's a, she
ape
works
lady.
There. Yeah. The man says this. One day I came home and my wife was feeding our baby daughter with one boob and a chimpanzee with the other. These are the words of a man married to the self-professed chimp mom, Pamela Rosary, who features in a new docuseries about a Hollywood ape and a woman who calls herself the Dolly Parton of chimpanzees, whatever that means.
Bragging rights.
Yeah. While she was very nonchalant about breastfeeding the chimp, her husband, Roger, was not quite so comfortable. One day, she's got Dallas on one boob and a chimp on the other. He says in the wild new show, Chimp Crazy. I said, whoa. What are you doing? A now grown-up Dallas says, we were like brother and sister. The moment a boy like
talking
me...
Talking about the chimp?
Yes. He'd throw poop at him. I can't imagine life without him.
The show follows the life of Tanya Haddix, who is the, again, blonde cosmetic surgery fan who works for the breeder, caring for seven apes at the Missouri Primate Foundation. The chimp mom, Tanya, is a mother to two chimps, admits she loves the animals. Oh, her name is actually Tanya. She loves the animals more than her own flesh and blood, even skipping school sports days to look after the primates. You can shape them into you. They don't grow up and get a mind of their own.
Yes, they do.
She reveals, they don't break your heart. They'll be your friend for life. I'm sorry, but there's nothing like monkey love. It's so empowering. You become their mother. It's like your love for God. However, her monkey antics soon got her into hot water as animal rights groups like PETA say she has no training or formal qualifications surrounding and looking out for primates, including the fact that she breastfeeds them. In the show, Tanya claims movie star Tonka, who was 38, weighed at least 14 stone and loved chicken nuggets. This is the chimp.
That's what, about 40 pounds, somewhere around there?
By the way,
wait a minute. That just sounds like a kid.
Hence, that was her thing, right? They don't grow up. Mm-hmm. They don't get a mind of their own. They'll break your heart. They'll break your femur, but they won't break your heart.
So the chimp was supposed to be picked up to be confiscated from her home. PETA showed up to confiscate the chimp. Guess what? He died the day before.
Oh.
No one believes the cause of death. She said he suffered a stroke in a scene on film, visibly distressed in a small cage, throwing himself against the metal bars. But yes.
You think she killed the chimp so it wouldn't go back?
I personally do, but I don't base it on anything other than I think this woman is nuts.
And did I miss this last week? Because SNL did a whole thing with this lady.
Okay,
They did.
I was not super familiar with it until that skit.
Put it this way, we just read about it last week, so I'm thinking, this show has not premiered yet. Or what? I guess it's already on, because, right, SNL was the thing to tip me off, because they had a woman playing this character. Basically, she's breastfeeding a chimpanzee on a $100,000 pyramid. It's its own thing, but I'm like, so this is the thing. People are aware of this now. Do you think we would know about her if not for the Tiger King? Right, the Tiger King was our first foray into, here's some crazy people dealing with exotic animals. Then, like, how do we one-up Tiger King? And there's not a lot you could do to one-up Tiger King until someone says, hey, man, I know this lady that breastfeeds the chimps. And you go,
that's the key.
Green light this.
Right, she's breastfeeding them.
Are you going to watch the show at all? Look, I'm not going to lie. If I remember to check it out, I will.
If I'm flipping through and it's on, I'll check it out. Yeah. But I'm not going to, like, you know, make sure I have it on my DVR.
Find out what happens.
Maybe at an intimate time, I'll put that on.
Yeah. Warm you up.
Home alone on the couch.
Hello, Tom. Welcome to the men's room.
Liquor and whores.
Liquor and whores.
Tom, welcome to the program. Random question, Let's go with this one. What is the most embarrassing way that you have injured yourself, or just one that you're not too proud of?
Oh my gosh. Worst injury. During sex.
Uh-oh, what'd you do?
So she had a granite slab table next to her that was her nightstand, and at climax I rolled over and cracked my skull open.
Oh, yeah, she busted it open.
Oh, blood and everything else was coming out.
Damn. Did you have to go to the hospital? Did you open up a wound that big?
Yes, I had to go to the hospital, and I didn't have to really describe it. I just said I hit my head, but I had to get seven stitches, and I was concussed.
Oh, you even knocked yourself out?
Oh, yeah.
Now, did you wake up, or did you just know that you had, rang your bell, so to speak?
I rang my bell hard enough. I was out for a little bit, but she, I'll put it gently, she took care of me.
All right. So she knew that you were not in a good state of mind there.
Yeah.
Probably
yeah,
all the blood was, and the head wound.
Yep. But she made sure I was all right.
Okay. All right. Well, I mean, hell,
if you got to hurt yourself.
That's not a bad way to do it.
And it wasn't during sex. You hit climax. You know, I'm just saying, if it's the middle of sex and something goes wrong, you're like, I still didn't get to the part that I wanted
to
get to.
It's like you crash your car, but you didn't. You pulled in the driveway
and
too much.
Driveway.
And you hit your garage door.
And you're like, all right, well, at least I'm home. All right, exactly. That's all.
Yeah. Razor asks, what's your most embarrassing injury and how did you do it? The loyalty, they say, the cuddles, the dopey eyes. There's a lot of joy in having a dog.
not the least of which is heading out for a walk, which dog owners do a few times a day. And therein lies a peril that some dog people should pay more attention to. Over the last 20 years, injuries related to dog walking have been on the rise among adults and children in the U.S., according to Johns Hopkins University researchers. They say running with a leash dog is particularly hazardous, no matter how well trained you think the dog is. Fractures, sprains, head trauma are among the most common injuries. From 2001 to 2020, the estimated number of adults seen in emergency departments for dog walking injuries increased significantly to 32,300 a year.
Good Lord, man.
Most of the patients at 75% were women. Adults overall between the ages of 40 and 64 amounted to about 50% of the emergency room visits. We know that a significant number of people might seek treatment at primary care or urgent care clinics for their injuries as well. Here's one dog owner's story. Susanna Johnson. She is a yoga instructor who has been injured three times while walking her dog over the years. 5 years ago, her 50-pound lab mix went after a squirrel while Johnson was kneeling to tuck a sweatshirt into her backpack.
Mm-hmm.
The leash wrapped around one hand, she fractured a finger. That was the worst because it was twisted and pulled, and I had to have surgery and rehab and everything else. They say staying safe when walking a leash dog takes diligence, focus, and in the aspect of inclement weather, extra precautions. You can't really afford to relax when you walk a powerfully built dog with the torque of a small tractor, according to one dog owner in Athens. You have to pay attention. Getting hit by vehicles is another risk that's happened while walking your dog. So don't go for a stroll in the night in the dark without wearing some bright colored clothes, reflectors, or any kind of light on your clothing.
Or don't walk in the street.
They also suggest very strongly not to use a retractable leash.
I do not use the retractable leash. It's a pain in the ass.
They're more likely to get tangled around your legs and cause falls. They can sometimes make your dog more difficult to control. A no-pull harness with a leash clipped to a dog's chest rather than their back is the preferred method, they say.
And that is what I walk my dog in. And we won't call it no-pull. We'll call it don't pull as hard for as long. Nothing matters to her. But, yeah, the retractable leash, I'm like, I'm this dog. There's no way. When she was a puppy, you want to chase everything. And look, to this day, and I get it, you're a dog, you see a squirrel or a rabbit, it's like, I want to kill it. Fine. But it was the crows when she was a puppy, right? So in the morning, crows are lined up on the fence, and she'd want to go after her. And I'm like, look, one, they can fly. Two, they seem to be taking pity on you, just the way they're eyeing you, recognizing that you're young and stupid. But, like, you need to cut this out, because they will remember you. And then they'll remember me as being the guy that's always with this vicious thing and attack me. So she's cool with the crows now. But I was like, no. Chase the squirrels, don't care. Rabbits, don't care. Crows, leave them the F alone.
Well, it's like that one woman in that report, like, I don't know, like, I don't want to sound sexist, but, like, I get nervous sometimes when they see a small woman with just a massive dog.
If that dog lurches forward, man.
Right. There's a lady in my complex that has, I mean, she is tiny, and the dog is big, and it's like, I'll give you benefit of the doubt that you trained it, but like, it looks like it's just dragging her around, and I'm like, if that thing wants to go, it's gone.
It's gonna go. I mean, look, you can train your dog, you can raise your kids, it doesn't mean your kids won't F up, it doesn't mean your dog is not gonna be excitable.
Yeah, it's still a dog.
Most of the time, they're decent. Hello, Gary, welcome to the men's room.
Hello, my brother.
Hola.
Gary, welcome to the program. Random question, let's go with this one. What was the reason that you or someone else had to call 911? Have you ever been in a situation where someone called 911?
That's crazy, because I was a first responder for many years. But 2 days ago, my wife collapsed in the kitchen in front of me. I was so close to her, I could grab her. And I had to take her and put her in a chair. She went out for about a minute and a half, and I was actually scared, so I had my granddaughter. It was Sunday, or not Sunday, but Saturday this happened, and I had my granddaughter call 911, and it was crazy. I was like, I used to be a CPR instructor and all that stuff. I was a cop for 10 years. You guys know this. I call in all the time. Anyway. Yeah, that scared the crap out of me.
Did you just kind of freeze then, based on the fact that it was somebody, you know, you obviously love and know? Or did you put into your training, any training that you knew, did you put into a practice?
dude, I, like I said, I was a combat air crewman. I was a combat medic. I didn't, there's no freezing. I knew exactly what was going on. So I just had to move her over and set her down and wait for 911. Because once you activate 911,
they're
going to come.
Yeah, they're coming. Yeah, what was wrong? Why did she collapse?
We're 65. We're 20 days apart. We're both retired, and she was dehydrated, is what we determined. So she wasn't drinking enough water. She just passed out, you know?
All right. Well, I'm glad everything's okay. How old was your granddaughter since she called 911?
She's 14, and she freaked, but we talked afterwards, and I explained to her and all that neat stuff, you know.
And she knew
for years, too.
She knew your address?
I'm sure she did, because I was busy taking care of the wife when the call was being made from another room, basically.
Okay.
Smart. My son is there, you know, it was...
hell of a way to spend the weekend with the grandparents.
Well, no, she lives with me. I have family here.
Okay.
We're part Filipino, American, Amerasian family, so you know how that goes.
Tons of
food. Everybody lives with everybody.
Yeah. I've been to one of your Christmas parties before. I've never seen so much fruit in a spread like that in my life. I was like, oh, my God. It was, 900 different dishes and tiki punch.
I would put Texas against them. It just, you could say there are two people, we're inviting one couple over for dinner. And they go, all right, we must smoke 18 pounds of ribs. Uh-huh. It's like, no, again, one couple. They're not bringing nothing. Just, it's one more couple. They're like, okay, then we'll do 22 pounds of ribs. It's unreal.
And the party was on. One room was a dance room. They had a karaoke thing set up on another, on a deck outside. Yeah. I mean, that party was absolutely hopping. You would go back for like two or three plates of food because you wanted to try
every single thing that's up there.
Thing and that spread. It was barbecue, you name it. Oh, the reason we asked, what's the reason you or someone else called 911? A 911 call was released of two self-proclaimed dumbasses who were arrested in Idaho for drug trafficking last year after believing they were being followed. The two self-proclaimed, again, dumbasses were driving high in Idaho with 20 pounds of marijuana. They called the police on themselves after they got spooked about cops following them. East Idaho News released audio of the 911 call from last year that led to the drug trafficking arrests of Leland Delente and Holland Sward, who are apparently so high and so paranoid they were certain that undercover cops were trailing them. They were traveling from Las Vegas to Montana.
Undercover, so not even squad cars.
Right, yes.
Undercover.
They were increasingly concerned that they were going to be arrested after crossing into the Idaho border. Eventually, the men decided to speed up the process of their arrest and called cops, politely requested, please just come and get us, just end it. They pulled over at a gas station and went into an Applebee's restaurant to wait. And they called the dispatcher from there. Hi, we're the two dumbasses that got caught trying to bring some stuff through your border, and all your cops are just driving around us like a bunch of jack wagons, and I just really wish for you guys to just end this. So if you could help me out with that, we would just like to get on with it. The dispatcher replied, you got caught doing what? Oh, God, okay. Kind of got spooked here trying to bring some stuff across the Idaho border. A bunch of your cops are driving around in a bunch of civilian cars not wanting to pick us up. I don't know what's the deal. It's getting cold out here, man. I just want to go into the Applebee's and get warm. When police showed up, the men had their hands behind their heads. The guy told the officer, we're surrendering, according to court records. They were each charged with felony counts of marijuana trafficking.
Wow.
The police captain told the news website that no police officers were following them at any point in time during their journey. More of the random question on the way, 206-803-ROCK.
This episode is brought to you by Progressive Insurance. Whether you love true crime or comedy, celebrity interviews or news, you call the shots on what's in your podcast queue. And guess what? Now you can call them on your auto insurance too with the Name Your Price tool from Progressive. It works just the way it sounds. You tell Progressive how much you want to pay for car insurance, and they'll show you coverage options that fit your budget. Get your quote today at progressive.com to join the over 28 million drivers who trust Progressive. Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and Affiliates. Price and coverage match limited by state law.
You're working from home. You settle in with a cup of coffee, ready to get the day started. Before you look at that to-do list, turn on your favorite Odyssey sports station on your smart speaker. We'll keep you company and bring you the latest updates from your teams while you tackle your inbox or get ready for another meeting that probably could have been an email. Power through the workday with the entertaining sports coverage you love from the local voices you trust. Just ask your smart speaker to play your favorite station.
KISW. The Men's Room returns with Miles and Thrill.
Count up your guess as good as mine. Our categories today: we have the best cities for foodies and the top 10 Seattle Seahawks players of all time. That's on the way right after emails and the random question. Question 206-803-ROCK.
Hello, Aiden. Welcome to the Men's Room. Hello, Aiden.
Random.
Hello, William. Welcome to the Men's Room.
Hello?
There we go. All right. Welcome to the random question. What do we have for you? How about we go with this one? Have you ever screwed up real bad at work? Ever kind of messed up there where you thought you maybe wouldn't have a job anymore, or maybe you lost it?
Well, yeah.
Well, what happened?
Well, how about... I was in charge of making some parts for the oil field, and these rings had to fit in between joints of pipe to seal it so that it wouldn't, you know, have a big oil leak, a big oil spill. And there might have been a box or two that went by without me checking, and they possibly failed.
Do you know they failed or they possibly failed?
I know they failed.
Okay, now when these particular parts fail, what is the end result of that?
The blowout, the oil will just blow out of the sides of the pipe and just run the down side of the pipe on the ground. You know.
Did you lose your job because of that, or were you able to keep your job?
I was able to keep my job, but I had to undergo more training. To prevent that from happening again.
Yeah, I all think right. That's probably fair. That's the right move.
Did it ever happen again?
No, not while I worked there. As a matter of fact, I was responsible for implementing a new inspection plan where if I got a box with 100 parts in it, I would measure 10. And if one of the 10 fail, all 100 are bad. If all 10 pass, then all 100 are good.
Okay.
And that really changed the scrap rate for that company in a good way.
Well, that's a good thing.
That's pretty.
Yeah, yeah. It turned out being good, yeah.
All right.
That is a fact. I think the worst I did, and there's a million of them, but the one where I really thought I was going to lose my job, and I've told this one before, but we used to run the Baltimore Ravens. We're the flagship station, but if you're the flagship station, and it's the same thing here in Seattle, then you are the master feed for every other radio station that carries that game. So whatever's going on down in Portland or wherever else they listen to the Seahawks, like whatever station carries them here, they're the guys running the show. And we had,
right, if you're in a different part of the state or whatever.
Yeah, you're getting the feed.
Put it to you this way. When they say we got to pause 10 seconds for station identification, if you're one of those things, that's the only time they're doing anything. It's all coming off the satellite from the flagship.
Correct. So, you know, we're the flagship. No big deal. I'm running master control. Kind of a cool thing. And there's like 9 of us in the studio. But understand, at that time, we were either on 17 or 18 other affiliates. I don't remember. And it's mostly Southern Pennsylvania. If you're running the Ravens, no big deal. But the game is on. The game's doing whatever they're doing. And this is during the game. At that time, it was CBS Radio, and they'd sent out some memo, and I don't remember what it was about. But CBS was notorious for sending out memos, where they pissed them on about the employees constantly. But his last one that came out, like, had everyone irritated. So I'm not alone in this, but mm-hmm. We're talking about it, and the studio, no boss is there, you know, so we're having an open conversation, and blah, blah, blah. What I did not realize was that as the game's being broadcast, I relax and rest my elbow on the board, but my elbow hit the mic on button. And once you turn the mic on in the studio, whatever else is going on, your voice is over top of it. It could be the presidential address, doesn't matter. You hit the on mic, You're talking over them. Well, I don't know that I've hit it. So the only thing that made it out over the radio, you're going to be like, and the Baltimore Ravens line up on 3rd and 8. And you just hear my voice go, that effing memo. I realized what I did, took my elbow off. Well, at that point, it's too late. And now there's this awkward silence in the studio. All these guys are looking at me. Just one of those, like, we feel bad for you looks like, you know, you just cussed. I'm like, man, I know, but there's nothing I can do. What's happened has happened. I'm like, crap. So then the hotline starts ringing maybe 2 minutes later. And they're like, dude, you got to answer the hotline. I said, no, I'm not going to answer the hotline. They said, it's the boss. I said, that's exactly why I'm not going to answer the hotline, because if I pick it up, he's going to fire me. But he can't really fire me if we don't have any communication, you see. So for the rest of the game, this hotline kept going on all through halftime, second half of the game. I'm like, I'm not going to answer the phone. And so they're kind of sweating bullets. I'm like, you guys are fine. I'm the one who just cussed on the air. And it went to multiple markets. All it was. So anyway, we finished the game. This is a Sunday. Come back.
Nobody else in that studio picked it up, though.
With a hotline? No, I'm sitting next to it.
Yeah.
Right? Just where it was. And it's like, dude.
Guarding it with his life.
Yeah, do not pick this up, because I already know it's Bob Phillips. He's going to fire my ass. I'm not going to answer it because it's Bob Phillips. He's going to fire my ass. So Monday, next day, I come into work acting like nothing's happening. And I mean, I take 2 steps in, and one of the other bosses just points at me and does the finger thing, the come here. And I'm in his office, and he was very low-key when he spoke. And he said, you know, I was at the Ravens game yesterday in a suite. I said, well, you guys do that all the time. You're the rich guys. He said, and then my phone blew up from 18 different program directors that swear that they heard an F-bomb go out over the air. I said, man, I heard about that, too. And he goes, then I listened to the tape, and it sounded suspiciously like you. I said, you know what, man? I heard the same thing from some other people. Now, he knows I'm lying.
Was there ever a follow-up as to who you heard this from?
No, I just said, like, other people, they've been talking about it all day. I may have heard about it last night, Bill. That's what I heard. And he said, so this is what I'm... He goes, but you don't know who's responsible, knowing it's me. And I'm just not... If you confess, the way CBS worked, if you confess, you're out. So I'm like, I don't know, bro. It's just what everyone kept telling me. So he said, okay, here's the deal I'm going to make with you. If it happens again, no, he said, go find the person who you think's responsible and let them know that if anything happens like this again, you lose your job. I'm like, I don't lose my job because of someone else. He said, if that's how you want to play this.
Yep.
I said, all right. Uh-huh. Well, I'm going to tell him. I'll tell him. If I don't lose my job, yeah, because your dumbass hit the mic. That's not right.
Raise my ass when he just screw up at work. A small Chinese company specializing in washing machines is facing a potential loss of about $4.2 million after employee mistakenly labeled products with the wrong prices.
Oops.
The small business in China had been forced to ask customers to cancel their orders after one employee's blunder caused a 20-minute online shopping spree that could result in a net loss of $4.2 million. 40,000 orders for various washing machines were placed on the small company's online store because someone noticed the pricing errors and basically told everyone. In that window, they sold 70 million yen worth of washing machines for about 40 million, which means it might have to incur losses of 30 million yen and might be forced to honor those orders.
Well, yeah.
Tens of thousands of orders and tens of thousands of yen are astronomical figures for us. We feel sincerely sorry for all the affected customers, the company said. We humbly beg you to understand our difficulties and to agree to withdraw orders, as we will refund it as fast as we can. Apparently, one of the company's employees accidentally labeled some of its washing machines with the wrong prices because they misunderstood the preferential pricing of its online store, which resulted in unbelievable heavy discounts that immediately caught shoppers' eyes. For an example, a washing machine that had been priced at 1,700 yen, they were being priced at 299.
Oh, yeah,
while
jump
models
on that.
That should have been 2,500 were at 440. Due to the misunderstanding, we made a significant mistake, the owner said. We recognize that this issue has caused confusion among the public and seriously disrupted the market. We feel deeply, deeply guilty and upset. Now, to convince people that the discount was a result of one person's mistake, they released a short clip of the employee responsible for the pricing error, in which they apologized for the blunder, adding that they couldn't cover the losses even if they sold every single thing they own. Authorities are currently investigating the case to see if they'll have to honor
the price of those machines.
Yeah, I don't know how that works in China.
Now we head to a dominatrix where Lorraine White was prosecuted by the fire service after they were called out to a blaze in Stockport but could not gain access to her underground chamber. Firemen have been called out to the address after a maintenance man reported a basement fire. Once they finally gained access, they discovered a grisly grotto full of handcuffs, chains, and several canisters of nitrous oxide, basically laughing gas.
Sure.
And that's sometimes used, I guess, by dominatrices to give their clients a momentary high. But prosecutors claim this could be dangerous if a fire broke out and those under the influence were unable to react.
Mm-hmm.
Wow, wow, wow.
Wait, is this they were doing whippets in her dungeon?
No, it said her dungeon, her sex dungeon, it didn't have a proper, basically, like ventilation or a fire escape plan. So if the fire is at the doorway of the sex dungeon, there were no windows for people to climb out.
Right.
So it doesn't quite meet the requirements.
Yeah, so she got several fines and fees for all of the things that were not correct.
I feel like you don't know.
Her defense lawyer described her client as a businesswoman of good character.
Not about the dungeon.
Yes. And more on screwing up their work. They say travelers have to entrust airlines to handle their luggage, but many of America's top companies have managed to lose people's personal items on their journeys. According to data released by the U.S. Department of Transportation, Southwest Airlines came in at number one, while American Airlines ranked second among companies that lose the most amount of luggage. Great, I'm going to be flying American here.
Oh, are you?
Oh,
all
yeah.
Right. Bring it, carry on.
I was going to check, too. Mishandled bags includes those lost, delayed, damaged, stolen. The data also showed the number of wheelchairs and scooters that were lost or mishandled in 2023 alone. Out of more than 470 million bags, about 2 million were mishandled by the airlines. Out of 800,000 wheelchairs, 1,200 were mishandled. Southwest Airlines took the number one spot with 587 bags mishandled out of more than 129 million that were loaded last year. In second, American Airlines with over 500,000 bags mishandled out of more than 71 million. When you look at those numbers, they don't seem the
worst. Percentage-wise, it's not awful.
United Airlines came in third. Delta, they came in fourth. Regional airline SkyWest, which I have never flown. How are we in the West and we've never flown SkyWest?
Right?
I don't know. Is it more like the Arizona area, like Southwest?
I feel like they just... I'm shocked somebody hasn't taken them up yet. I feel like I've been on one, but not as
I've heard of them, but I've never been on a flight.
Believe it or not, Alaska Airlines, the fifth largest airline in North America, came in sixth place. Then you have JetBlue, which came in seventh place. So whatever you can say about JetBlue, you can say about it. But
you get your bag.
You get your bag.
I love JetBlue.
They say Southwest not only came in first for having
that's
the
what
most...
I want to say about it.
Yeah, they're, Airlines have 21 days to find and return missing luggage, at which point travelers are entitled to claim compensation.
All right.
So either way, knock on wood, have not had that happen in a while.
Random. Give it time. Random. Hello, Aiden. Welcome back to the men's room.
Hey, yo, what's good?
Hola.
Aiden, welcome to the program. Random question.
What? Clear the control number and... Of course.
You busy, bro?
Are you still at work?
Hey. Yes, I'm still at work, actually. I just finished work.
I'm an air traffic controller.
Mm-hmm. I'm a surgeon.
No, I'm a... I work for U-Haul as a mobile mechanic. I just finished work out here in Graham.
Oh, okay.
All right. Let's see here, Aiden. What do we got for you? Okay, where would you like to live for a while? If it was a certain residence, a town, a state, a city... where would you like to live for a while if you could?
Honestly, I would say in Germany, because I actually, when I graduated high school, I got the chance to go out there and stay there I stayed there with my school for about 2 weeks, and then my parents came out and we stayed there for the rest of the month.
What was that sound?
And the biggest reason I say that is because, dude, how healthy the people in Germany live. It's absolutely crazy. And when I was out there, I felt so much better than I ever did living here in America.
All right. What town did you live in Germany?
I stayed in Frankfurt for about 2 weeks. And then when my parents finally came out, we kind of jumped around. And then eventually we actually went out to Amsterdam. And holy crap, man. Out in the Netherlands, it is absolutely crazy.
as far as what, the beauty of it or as far as the lifestyle?
The beauty of it. And then on top of that, one of the places we got to stay in, we saw some like crazy looking lights. And I know you guys probably already know they grow a lot of weed out there. And we asked the people that were housing us what was with the lights. And they told us the lights, like at night, they were so bright, they shined all the way up into the sky. And we asked them and they said that's actually was a weed grow plant. That it ran all day, 24/7.
All right. I mean, that makes sense.
I guess it was outdoors then, right?
I bet it's better than smoke pouring out of a smokestack.
Yeah.
A little light pollution, weed.
Oh, yeah, exactly, right. Yeah.
How about the language situation? Was that easy to overcome that, or could you speak a little German?
It was relatively easy. So if you ever go to Europe, their second language out there typically is English, but I also did learn German for about 3 years before I went out there. And that's the whole reason that I was actually out there was my German class.
That but makes sense.
Even if you couldn't really understand them and they immediately would realize that you were American, they would immediately start talking English to you.
All right. Okay.
I think all Germans have to, like, in grade school, you got to take, like, a year or two of English.
I think so, because basically it's the language of business.
Right, so, like,
yeah,
like in Munich.
Out there in Germany, they, I think, one of their classes is English, and then they also get the opportunity to take another language. Like, my exchange student, when I was with the school, he spoke German, English, and he also spoke French.
That makes sense.
It does.
Right, because like in Munich and stuff, like obviously most of those people still use English all the time.
Sure.
But like in that little town we were in, Wolfrathausen, they were not good with English.
No.
And like that other couple at breakfast came in and started speaking Spanish, and the one waiter had an easier time talking Spanish to them than he did English to us.
Which, by the way, it's just weird. Anytime I hear someone speaking Spanish, if it's their second language, it's someone from the U.S. So there's a way we sound when we speak Spanish doesn't sound weird. To hear someone speak Spanish with a bit of a German accent.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I was like, dude, I am completely lost in this.
Yeah. And originally, like the first time I went overseas to see the Seahawks was in London.
Mm-hmm.
And I did not know about the Germans all knowing a certain amount of English. And I'm in this bar talking to a Seahawks fan. And then finally, he's staring at me. And his buddy goes, he is German. You're going too fast.
Ah, right.
And he doesn't know what you're talking about now.
I got up unusually early, like 5:45 in a hotel room over the weekend, and I couldn't sleep, but the continental breakfast thing.
Yeah.
That opens up at 6. So I'm like, all right, I'll go outside, I'll smoke a cigarette, I'll try to get one out of me, and then I'll go down, I'll get a cup of coffee, because I'll have all this stuff ready to go at 6 o'clock, and I'll go downstairs, and there was a guy beside me, and I said, hey, man, good morning, how's it going? And he stopped, and he turned to me and he looked, and I was like, oh no. And he's like, it is good. It is going good. And
okay.
I was like, oh, okay. All right. Yeah. Well, good morning. He's like, thank you.
American.
Going good.
Yeah.
For asking. Like, and I'm like, all right, man.
All right.
Like,
I got what you're
saying.
I
can't speak freaking anything other than English.
Thank what accent did he have? You have no idea, dude.
I don't know. I mean, I know the area of the world, but I don't know, you know, but I mean.
Where do you think he was from?
I don't really know, but I know he was, you know.
Like Eastern European style or.
You can say he was Asian. I just don't know where he's from.
Okay.
I mean, you know, like, I don't know if he was, you know.
Laotian, Thai, Korean.
But he was, then he tried to keep talking to me. I was talking to him. His English was very good, but he was very deliberate, and he just wanted to make sure that he could. And he actually enjoyed the conversation.
Did he?
Well.
Did he say. I enjoy.
I have to go. Yeah. A new phone. Who dis?
Yeah. Right? Yeah. Well, he was making tea. I was making coffee. You know, so we each had our own little station there. We were talking to each other.
I like the idea. You're just ripping coffee. Like, yeah, man, let's keep chatting.
Yeah, exactly. Right. Hey, it's 6 a.m., man. What are we doing?
Right. You play golf?
Breeze, we asked, where would you like to live for a while? I want to spend a day.
Austin, Texas.
Well, that's not a bad spot either.
Malta.
Spent a few nights in Prince's childhood home, not his actual real home, but the one that he played as the character in Purple Rain. In honor of the movie's 40th anniversary, it is now offered up as an Airbnb. It's in Minneapolis. It's been transformed into a shrine to both the movie that you saw as far as it was on screen and Prince himself. You'll get to listen to Prince's personal tape collection when you're in there. You can actually wear one of the outfits he wore.
And you won't fit in it.
Yeah. There's even a music lounge.
Child.
There's an app that'll teach you to play or sing Purple Rain on karaoke. There's a secret door that leads to a room filled with treasures. Wendy and Lisa, by the way, from the Revolution, they're the ones responsible for all this.
Uh-huh.
They are offering 25 one-night stays between October 26th and December 14th. Guess how much it costs to spend the night there?
$5,000.
If you win the lottery, which everyone will have to do, it's $7 a night.
Oh,
in
really?
In honor of Prince's Song 7. Which, by the way, was not on the Purple Rain soundtrack, so I have no idea what's going on there. All right, coming up, your guess as good as mine in categories of best cities for foodies and the top 10 Seattle Seahawks of all times. And we got your emails on the way next from the men's room at KISW.com.
What's up? It's your boy, the Ted Smith from the men's room. And did you know I have a podcast? Well, I do. The Podcast. New episodes uploaded every Wednesday on the Odyssey app.
This episode is brought to you by Progressive Insurance. Whether you love true crime or comedy, celebrity interviews or news, you call the shots on what's in your podcast queue. And guess what? Now you can call them on your auto insurance too with the Name Your Price tool from Progressive. It works just the way it sounds. You tell Progressive how much you want to pay for car insurance and they'll show you coverage options that fit your budget. Get your quote today at progressive.com to join the over 28 million drivers who trust Progressive. Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and Affiliates. Price and coverage match limited by state law.
You're working from home. You settle in with a cup of coffee, ready to get the day started. Before you look at that to-do list, turn on your favorite Odyssey sports station on your smart speaker. We'll keep you company and bring you the latest updates from your teams while you tackle your inbox or get ready for another meeting that probably could have been an email. Power through the workday with the entertaining sports coverage you love from the local voices you trust. Just ask your smart speaker to play your favorite station. You're working from home. You settle in with a cup of coffee, ready to get the day started. Before you look at that to-do list, turn on your favorite Odyssey sports station on your smart speaker. We'll keep you company and bring you the latest updates from your teams while you tackle your inbox or get ready for another meeting that probably could have been an email. Power through the workday with the entertaining sports coverage you love from the local voices you trust. Just ask your smart speaker to play your favorite station.
This episode is brought to you by Progressive Insurance. Whether you love true crime or comedy, celebrity interviews or news, you call the shots on what's in your podcast queue. And guess what? Now you can call them on your auto insurance too with the Name Your Price tool from Progressive. It works just the way it sounds. You tell Progressive how much you want to pay for car insurance, and they'll show you coverage options that fit your budget. Get your quote today at progressive.com to join the over 28 million drivers who trust Progressive. Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and Affiliates. Price and coverage match limited by state law.
You're working from home. You settle in with a cup of coffee, ready to get the day started. Before you look at that to-do list, turn on your favorite Odyssey sports station on your smart speaker. We'll keep you company and bring you the latest updates from your teams while you tackle your inbox or get ready for another meeting that probably could have been an email. Power through the workday with the entertaining sports coverage you love from the local voices you trust. Just ask your smart speaker to play your favorite station.
Are you a bartender that dreads the phrase, "Hey, can you put the game on?" At Sports on What, we understand your pain and we're here to help. Over the air, satellite, cable, or streaming, Sports on What knows what channel the game is on and you can too. Follow your favorite teams, set alerts, and filter by provider to get the results you need. Stop wasting time searching and never miss kickoff again. Just download the Sports on What app and you'll always know how to watch the game. Available for Android and iOS. Start your 7-day free trial when you download Sports on What and subscribe today.
We now return to the men's room, 99.9 KISW.
Your guess is as good as mine. Cut out the categories today. The best cities for foodies and the top 10 is Seattle Seahawks, the greatest players of all time. But first, time for a few emails to the men's room at KISW.com.
You've got mail.
Jump right into birthdays, guys. Gentlemen, please help me wish my husband, Anthony, a very happy 33rd birthday. How about some green beans and the dirty Germans describing their favorite things to do with a plumber? Thanks a lot, guys. That from Kylie.
Green beans, green beans, green beans, green beans.
Yeah, anytime I'm spending sexy time with a plumber, we play a little game called Plumber. And what I do is Roto-Root is the place where the poops come from.
Yeah, we'd like to play Phil's the Crack, because you can always see that when they're working on things.
or we play plunger. Well, his face is just the suction part.
Yeah, you just hear the sound.
Hello, brothers. Want to wish my brother from another mother, Mike, a very happy 40th birthday. He got me addicted to Call of Duty, and he's an all-around fun guy. So please give him a cut that bitch off and the captain telling him his favorite times with the mascots. Thanks, brothers. That from Maverick.
Cut that bitch off. Next caller.
Ooh, well, ahoy there. One of my more memorable liaisons with my mascot friends is when we crossed paths with Diego Ibanez, a.k.a. El Bastardo Feo Que Huelo Rero. That would be the ugly bastard who smells weird, and that nickname proved to be true. He was a Guatemalan drug lord. He hired us on the SS Gummy to transport a few hundred kilos of his product, which is made from paint thinner fumes, smelling salts, beaver knuckles.
Oh! Come on.
Beg your pardon?
Beaver knuckles, Windex, and one tablespoon of Meow Mix. Basically, you put it all in a blender, take a sip, see what happens. Side note, Frankenberry used to look like Brad Pitt until he had a sip of that, so be warned. Well, El Bastardo Feo Que Huelo Rero, he was also a wanted drug lord, so he hid out on the old guppy with me and the other mascots. But by the time we reached U.S. waters, El Bastardo Feo Que Huelo Rero reemerged from a cabin. He'd undergone a sex change so that no one would know who he was. And now you know him as the Land of Lakes Lady. And now he's a paid mascot, no one's the wiser. Good times. Crunch Bears.
Gentlemen, today's my boss's birthday, Kelly. She's 47 years old. Could she get an Obama, drop the beat, and next caller? I've only been working with her for a few months, but she is hands down the best manager I have ever worked for. As ever, forever grateful for the men's room players. Thank you, guys. That from the Jackster.
Drop the beat.
Cut that bitch off. Next caller.
Guys, I want to give a birthday shout-out to my bro, Gary Jones, who celebrates his 56th trip around the sun. Couldn't do it without you, brother. Can I get an oh, look out, your penis is too small, and the dirty Germans telling him what one should do at 56. Love the show. Keep it real. You guys make Seattle great. Thanks, guys. That from Jeff.
Uh-oh, look up.
The penis is too small!
Yeah, for me, what I decided to do was check to see if the quote is true. Is my penis too small? Maybe da, maybe nah.
Yeah, so I think it's pure and simple. What to do when you're 56? A little person.
Oh,
so that's what I did in Deutschland.
All right, guys, here you go.
Happy, happy, happy birthday. Happy, happy, happy birthday. Happy, happy, happy birthday to you, to you, to you.
Yaws of Dirty Germans, brought to you by Men's Room Original Sausage. Available through Uli's World Famous Sausage, mensroomlive.com, and other fine retailers. Mmm, Schweinefleisch.
Thank you, Mom. Let's get some contestants on the line. For your guess is as good as mine now at 206-803-ROCK. We do have time for a couple of extra locations for the Men's Room IPA from Black Raven Brewing. And away we go. Found the beer, guys, from Nathan. He says he was at the Cave Craft Beer in Redmond. Off of 85th, right there, in the bright yellow can. Nathan, thanks for the picture, man. Yeah. Thanks for the email. We appreciate that.
I love any place that has a beer cave.
Couple more. Hola, fellas. I keep forgetting to ride in. A couple weekends ago.
Forgetting, we're not in love anymore.
Voice of an angel.
Couple weekends ago, I caught a show at the WAMU Theater and found the beer available in the tall, bright yellow can. They got the big one at the WAMU.
Oh, nice.
They were required to pour it into a compostable cup, but whatever.
It's all right.
I thought it was just the stadium carrying it for a sports event, so that was awesome. Rock on, guys. P.S. I'm writing this while waiting for my flight to push back to San Diego. Ted might appreciate that I'll be seeing Idris Elba spinning the ones
Idris
and
Alba.
Two. Idris Elba spinning the ones and twos at a house and techno festival.
Nice.
Hey,
on the beautiful downtown waterfront.
He's a DJ as well. That's awesome. Jealous.
Yeah, let's see. Greetings, you degenerates. Saw this during a pit stop at, well, the Pit Stop Express in South Hill in Puyallup. Also, they sell actual booze here, and it's next to a 24-hour Subway. So grab your Men's Room IPA, your bourbon, your bacon sandwich, all in one stop. Thanks, guys. That from Bacon and one more. Hola, Bacholas. My punk rock band, Middle Finger Drive. Oh, this is from last week, but still. playing at Tony V's in Everett with Gorilla Grenaders, and not for nothing. More importantly, I'll be there eating delicious food and sucking down Men's Room IPA on draft. So if you're ever up in Everett, Tony V's is a great spot.
Yes,
great
it
spot
is.
Great spot for live music, great food, and they carry the beer on draft. So, Tony, thank you for doing that. That's awesome. And please continue to send us locations when you find them for the Men's Room IPA. Shoot us a pic as well, and we'll get as many mentions out there for you as
of
you
the
can.
Beer.
Yeah, if you got a favorite businessman, local little bar that serves the beer, let us know, and we'll give you a free plug there. All right. Time for Your Guess Is As Good As Mine. It's an easy game to play. You pick from one of two categories and then see how many you can get right in said category before three strikes and you're out. So, Steve, who is our contestant? Ready to play Your Guess Is As Good As Mine.
I'll be honest with you, Miles. I have no idea. But he says his name is Justin. Hello, Justin. Welcome to the program.
Ahoy.
Hola. Ahoy.
Justin, how are you, man? Welcome to Your Guess Is As Good As Mine. The categories today, just out today from Wallet Hub, we have the 10 best foodie cities in America. They did comparisons on 28 different key metrics. They compared 180 of the largest U.S. cities. Data set ranges from cost of groceries to the affordability and accessibility of high-quality restaurants, number of food festivals, blah, 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 blah. These are the 10 best foodie cities in America. Then we have for you the top 10 greatest Seahawks of all times. And if you need a little help there, I can give you the position. You might be able to guess the player. So do you want to go Seahawks or do you want to go foodie cities?
Man, I am super excited to go home and sit on my butt and watch the Seahawks tonight. But honestly, I am not real good with all the names and all that. So let's just go with the foodie cities.
All right.
We're never getting that list.
I keep trying to put it out there appropriately.
I know, yes. Man.
By the way, believe it or not, St. Louis has the most gourmet specialty food stores per square foot of any population.
St. Louis, Missouri.
St. Louis, Missouri.
In the United States.
Pearl City, Hawaii has the fewest.
Pearl City.
Miami has the most restaurants. 21 times more than Pearl City, Hawaii.
Which is crazy because everyone there is on Coke and typically you're not hungry.
Orlando, Florida
has
the
most
ice cream and frozen yogurt shops.
The land of Disney, you don't say.
Okay, so I will give you the, I'll tell you what I'll do here. I'll help you out a little bit. There are three cities on the list from California, if you want to start there or start wherever you like.
We'll start right here at home. Well, I live on the eastern side of the state now, but Seattle.
Seattle, Washington is number 8 on the list.
Oh, nice.
And that makes sense. We are definitely a foodie city. We've got some great restaurants.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely. Let's just move down the coast. How about Portland?
Portland, Oregon is number 4.
Wow.
Yeah, they're a foodie city mecca.
I don't know why that surprises me, but it does.
Yeah, a lot of cultural diversity, a lot of different kinds of restaurants. Portland's a great spot to eat. I've never...
You say cultural diversity?
Well, as far as...
What part of Europe are you from?
Oh, no, Hillsboro's... Oh, Korean barbecue, Thai food. Jesus.
All right. Well... Keep going south. San Diego.
Number 10. All right. You got one California town. I don't know why that was a bad thing to say.
I don't know how bad. And I have not visually seen that.
I gotcha. Okay, all right. You got to get out.
All right. How about San Francisco?
San Francisco's number 2.
I thought that'd be number 1
number
for sure.
Number 2 foodie city in the United States. Okay, so there's one more city in California. There are, let's see here. 3 cities, believe it or not, in Florida that are the top in the top 10 of foodie cities in America.
Gotta have Miami is one. I don't know where.
Tampa?
Maybe.
Well, let's stick with California real quick. Let's see if we can get this one knocked out. Let's just go with L.A.
Los Angeles, number 13.
Huh.
For foodies.
Now that's a diverse city.
Yeah. Yes.
All right, we'll come back to California next.
All right. So Florida's got 3.
Got it. I gotta think. Well, you said Florida, but I still gotta think. It's gotta be in New York City too, right?
That's probably a strong guess.
Yeah, I'll guess New York.
Number 16.
Really?
Yes.
Damn.
Trust me, I'm right there with it.
Oh, man, maybe Washington, D.C. Don't guess it yet, but maybe.
I think
DC.
We just go with Miami. We know there's 3 in Florida.
Yeah.
You want to go with Miami?
Let's go Miami, Ted.
Number 1 food city
all
in America.
All right.
Miami, Florida. Now, think about the other place we always say there's action. No one ever remembers it for whatever reason. But when it comes to a city in Florida that does very well, as far far as population, tourist attractions.
Like Orlando, maybe?
Orlando.
Yeah. I mean, it's kind of like the Frankfort, Kentucky of Florida.
All right, Orlando.
Orlando is number three on the list. Orlando, Florida, the number three city for foodies in America. So far, you're correct with San Diego, California, 10. Seattle, Washington, at 8. Portland, Oregon, at 4. 3 is Orlando. San Francisco is 2. And 1 is Miami, Florida. There is one city left in Florida. There's one city in California. There's one city in Nevada. And one city in Colorado left on the list. You've got 6 out of the 10. 2 strikes against you.
I think Vegas and Denver are pretty
good.
Well, okay,
you take Colorado. We got to go Denver.
Denver, number 9. Very good.
All right. And then you said Nevada, so I just got to assume that's Las Vegas.
No, sorry, it's Reno.
Yeah.
No, Vegas yeah, is right. Vegas is 7. I have 2. That's the joke.
Okay, so we got 2 left.
Okay,
California,
you got
to
and Florida.
Florida. Well, I guess let's go Sacramento.
Sacramento's number 6.
Wow.
Really?
Wow.
Very good.
Good work, Sacramento.
What kind of rat would you like? They're locally sourced.
10 different ways.
Okay, I'm going to need some help down there in Florida. Never been there.
All right, so
we got Orlando, we got Miami.
That's correct.
So I'm thinking Tampa, Jacksonville. Where else do we have out there?
Man, I think maybe Tampa over Jacksonville or Gainesville or any of that stuff. I don't know that, but that would be my guess.
Because I don't think Gainesville is just big enough.
And the thing is, people visit Tampa without having family there. Or the other places, I feel like if you don't have family, you're not going there.
I'm leaning Tampa.
Tampa, but I don't know. I wouldn't be shocked. Maybe Jacksonville's got something going on we don't know about.
Right, Tallahassee. Like, is there some weird capital foods? No.
Yeah, in Tallahassee, brother. There's a crayon color for that.
I feel confident saying Tampa.
But I like Ted's confidence. Let's go Tampa.
Tampa, Florida's number 5. You could do. 2 strikes against you. You're correct on all 10 foodie series in America. San Diego, California, 10. Denver is 9. Seattle, 8. Vegas, 7. Sacramento, 6. 5 is Tampa. 4, Portland, Orlando, 3. 2, San Francisco. 1 is Miami. Do you guys want to do a speed round real quick on
Let's
the Seahawks and just get this thing
Let's
over with?
Let's just do
Since
it.
No one ever is going to pick any of these. We have one wide receiver. Does anyone want to guess?
Steve Largent.
Steve Largent is, in fact, the top Seattle wide receiver of all time. He comes in at number 2.
Walter Jones.
Maybe the greatest tackle ever to play offensive tackle is number 1.
Ayo.
As far as Seahawks and the greatest ones.
Sean Alexander.
Because we only had one running back and he's the MVP, so.
Well, Marshawn's legendary, but I don't.
Oh.
Marshawn Lynch.
Marshawn Lynch is on the list. There's your running back.
All right.
At number 7, we've got one linebacker.
Bobby Wagner.
Bobby Wagner, that is correct. At number 6, we have 2 safeties.
Chancellor.
Yeah, Chancellor's got to be on there.
And who's the guy that went to the Ravens?
Earl Thomas.
Earl Thomas is on the list. Are you guys guessing Cam Chancellor?
I don't know. You're making me nervous about it. What other safeties could we have back there?
One of the earlier ones, which is considered one of the greatest players of all time on the Ring of Honor.
Ooh. Damn.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I'm going to say Cam Chancellor.
What was your buddy's name with a nice ass?
Nicely?
Close.
Easily.
Kenny Easley. Kenny. Yeah. Close. All right. Kenny Easley is on
We're
the
We're losing points to Seahawks fans.
Right.
Uh-huh. Okay, so we have one cornerback.
Richard Sherman. Norman.
Richard Sherman, number 10. We have 1 defensive tackle.
DT.
Cortez Kennedy.
Number 4. Yeah, we have 1 quarterback.
Russell Wilson
at number 3. And the only one you guys will never get is at number 9. He played from 1980 to 1991. One of the best players to ever don a Seahawks uniform. 6'3", 255 pounds.
What position?
Big boy.
He was a defensive end.
And he played it that long.
Mm-hmm.
Right? I mean, I've been here. I don't have it. I don't got it.
I don't even know if you've heard the name before.
Right? I don't know that Who I have.
It is Jacob Green.
Jacob Green. All right.
Jacob Green. There's your top 10 Seattle Seahawks of all time. Speaking of, I think they played tonight.
Do they?
I've heard something about
is that. Game on?
Coming up, we'll drink it. Tell us with a shot of the day. You are listening to The Men's Room.
This episode is brought to you by Progressive Insurance. Whether you love true crime or comedy, celebrity interviews or news, you call the shots on what's in your podcast queue. And guess what? Now you can call them on your auto insurance too with the Name Your Price tool from Progressive. It works just the way it sounds. You tell Progressive how much you want to pay for car insurance, and they'll show you coverage options that fit your budget. Get your quote today at progressive.com to join the over 28 million drivers who trust Progressive. Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and Affiliates. Price and coverage match limited by state law.
You're working from home. You settle in with a cup of coffee, ready to get the day started. Before you look at that to-do list, turn on your favorite Odyssey sports station on your smart speaker. We'll keep you company and bring you the latest updates from your teams while you tackle your inbox or get ready for another meeting that probably could have been an email. Power through the workday with the entertaining sports coverage you love from the local voices you trust. Just ask your smart speaker to play your favorite station.
99.9 KISW. The shenanigans continue. This is the Men's Room with Miles and Thrill.
All right, Tuck, out of minutes. We'll drink and tell us for the shout of the day. And we do have your headlines on the way at 5:50. But first, quick check on Mike Hogg and some of the stories and headlines he is not working on.
Well, thank you, Miles. Officials are investigating what could possibly be the first case of human-to-human bird flu transmission.
Shouldn't we just call it human flu then?
Right?
How's it still bird flu?
Yeah, come on. I'm so messing up. No, birds had it. We took it.
It is still technically an avian flu, so I don't know what it is, like the bugs inside of it that are faulty or whatever, but it's never actually made the jump from human to human. We just tend to beat it within ourselves, and we can't transmit it. This has been the first time that they're like, oh, wait, no, this is actually avian flu.
You ever walk by a bird on the street and they sneeze? Oh, bless you, bro. Bless you, man. You must have that avian flu.
You son of a bitch.
It's just
cover your face.
Does it come in threes with you, too?
Just sitting there rubbing its throat. Anybody got a Ricola?
Maybe we should do that. Start handing out Ricola, see if it helps.
I figured a goose would be a good spokesman for Ricola. Because they already got the yodeler out there.
Yeah, the problem is nobody likes geese. Well, like, take the least popular celebrity and have them endorse a product. Like, hire Diddy to endorse your product right now. See how that goes.
I suppose that's why they do an insurance company. But
is that a goose or a duck?
No, it's a duck, isn't he? My bad,
Keep in mind, geese, the Diddy of the bird world.
Right, I'm a bird racist. I just think they all look alike.
What do you say, Mike? I'm a duck.
A recent survey of medical students found that 58% of students received no formal education on nutrition. What's worse, those who did averaged 3 hours of education per year.
And what's the number one leading cause of death?
I believe that's heart disease.
And the number one leading cause of heart disease in this particular country?
Poor nutrition.
Right.
Isn't there like specialization in like the doctor field? It seems some are surgeons, some would be nutritionists. Right?
Sure.
Right, but I would still think, as a general practitioner, I just feel like that should be part of the curriculum, right? Like, you could specialize in it.
And is that our fault? Do we just not want to accept the advice? It's like, you need to change your diet. You need to quit eating the garbage that you do.
Well, look, I built a car for you. You drove too fast and crashed into a tree.
Right.
Okay.
You know, like, my job is to build the car or repair the car.
Sure.
Or whatever.
But if you take it into the mechanic and they say, okay, well, we can, you know, put this specialty battery on there that'll help kick it along. It's like, no, it needs new tires.
Right.
You're driving on bad tires. That's all you got to do.
I mean, in the end, it isn't about people taking people's advice. Like, there's nothing wrong with Oxycontin. We just choose to abuse it.
Right. It's just...
But yeah, I do feel like that should be something that they're, you know, medically equipped with.
The foods that we got out there are already trying to kill us.
I would say this. If my kid has to read Shakespeare in high school, I definitely think doctors should learn about nutrition. Because I bet it'll come in more handy for the doctor than Shakespeare ever will for my kid.
They're spending a crap ton of time and a crap ton of money to be in that college anyway.
Teach me every damn thing you know.
Right, learn some nutrition. I feel like nutrition is like one of the biggest things that you can do just to make yourself feel better.
Sure.
Yeah, you could take ibuprofen to make your hangover better, but you could also eat properly and drink water and then you'll be fine too.
First of all, Pedialyte, not ibuprofen.
Pedialyte, my bad.
You could go to school for 10 years and still want a french fry.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's not going to stop the craving.
Exactly right. A new study found that working out on the weekends yields the same benefits as working it into your weekly schedule. So basically, you don't need to do the every other day thing and, you know, do a Monday, Wednesday, Friday and have a rest day and you do legs this day and you do. Cramming it all on the weekends yields the same same benefit.
Okay.
Wow.
Yeah.
All right. So it's kind of like binge drinking.
Yeah, you do it on the weekends.
Yeah.
Right.
Well, you should have
more. But if you spread it out over the week, you do just as much damage.
You should have more time. So hopefully you're in there a little bit longer.
Exactly.
Because I'm always like, if I go to the gym, it's like, I need to leave because I need to go get ready to go to work.
Right.
Well, and then if you're doing it during the week, you know, like I said, you're doing arms this day, you're doing legs this day, you're doing cardio, you're doing, you know, whichever. If you're doing it on the weekends, full body exercise, do some cardio in there. Like, yeah, you're putting an hour, maybe two into it if you're crazy. I don't know.
I'm not. 2 hours.
I'm not doing a damn thing. I'm just trying to fight to stay alive over here. Like, the workouts that I get is walking my dog and then walking from the bus station up here.
Yeah, I just feel like 2 hours, man. That's a long time.
Yeah. Yeah, don't take my advice.
I'm
going to
eat twice as much.
Yeah, exactly. Cleaning is never something that we enjoy doing.
I will say the Saturday post-gym beer is pretty good.
Mm-hmm. It is. You always feel dirty doing it. Like, it doesn't even have to be post-gym that on the weekends. If I work out, like, in the morning, shower up, grab a beer, I'm good.
Yeah.
I mean, the day's over at that point. Do what you want.
Yeah, exactly. I already did my good for the day. Cleaning is never something that we enjoy doing, but luckily for us, people have found ways to make it just a little bit easier on ourselves.
The Men's Room Top 10. The Men's Room Top 10.
The most brilliant cleaning hacks of all time. It's not often that I brag about a hack that has served me time and time again. To clean thoroughly and efficiently, the first thing you need to do is gather the right ingredients. 1. A tall rocks glass. 2. Ice, if you prefer. Lots of cubes or one big rock. 3. Fill that glass with whiskey. Its cleaning properties are immeasurable. Start with the living room, move on to the kitchen, then the bath, and finally the bedroom. The cleaning ratio is one glass for each room. So by the time you reach the bedroom, you don't care anymore and can take a nice nap.
Yeah.
He's not wrong.
You bet.
Like, I have a vacuum beer. I got a vacuum dusting. I had a vacuum cat litter scoop yesterday.
Oh, yeah.
I don't recommend that one.
No, man.
It was kind of the residual beer. It followed me to do the cat litter. And I'm like, I don't know if I want to finish drinking that now.
All right. Doggone it.
Yeah.
You know, I'll grab one when I'm cleaning out the bathroom. You know.
Always.
Got to clean out the bedroom. Let me just grab another beer here real quick.
My wife's always like, how do you get drunk already? I'm like, clean.
I smoke weed.
Really? That slows me down, man.
No, I smoke weed and just forget that I'm cleaning.
Both would be my recommendation.
Do you like
the weed helps your focus?
Right. Do you put on music at least?
Typically I'll have like sports on or music or something. But yeah, I mean, I'm stoned.
Oh, God. Yeah. See, I go way too slow if I'm stoned.
Really?
I can't do it.
I get lit. I take longer to do it, not because I'm going slow, but like you are laser focused on everything.
Yeah. I'm with Mike. My day's got to be done.
Yeah. I just want to sit down. You know, if there's sports on and I'm stoned, I want to sit down and I want to watch them.
Ravens played last night, so my benefit was I just put on Red Zone as my background noise.
There you go.
And clean, which that actually was kind of nice. Room to room, I'm just hearing football updates.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, you know, for teams that scored, sorry, Jets and Broncos fans, but teams that had highlights.
Yeah, if you hear something exciting, then you walk in there.
Then I walk in, yeah, that's it.
So this comes to us from GetPocket.com, GetPocket.com.
G-I-T or G-E-T?
E-T.
Well, I don't know if it's GetPocket or GetPocket.
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 And they actually have a handful, so some honorable mentions. Basically, they say, like, use the coffee stains that you have. They recommend using baking soda on those to get those out. To clean your silverware, clean it with aluminum foil, apparently.
Really? Wait, just rub it on there, I guess?
Yeah, they say a glass, let's see, here's what you need. A glass baking dish lined with aluminum foil or an aluminum baking dish, baking soda, salt, and boiling water. And apparently, the science project-like reaction should begin to remove the tarnish immediately.
Huh.
Yeah. What else they got here? Simmer baking soda and water in your I don't know. There's a little pot there that's taking care of that. Add a bowl of vinegar to your dishwasher.
I've heard that help get rid of the stink in there.
I haven't done that one.
Using a mesh laundry bag in your for your dishwasher.
Mm-hmm. So you should also have one of those if you like to float a river in the summertime.
Yes.
Or if you have lots of bronze. Because
the mesh one, like they cinch up. So you just toss all your beers in there and tie it up to your float and it stays cold in the water.
And Miles, you're 100% on that. My mom would toss her stockings in a mesh bag all the time when she was washing.
Yep.
Keeps them from getting trapped.
Tangled up and all.
Oh, you bet, dude. So number 10 of the brilliant cleaning hacks, they say that this is a do-it-yourself pot scouring pad using mesh produce bags. It says, you know those mesh produce bags that you get when you buy a dozen lemons or something like that? Or a whole lot of potatoes? It says, don't...
You're not doing
that? You don't get the big bag of lemons?
No.
Oh.
I don't feel like if I don't have a recipe calling for it, I don't make enough gin and tonics. Or, like, I'm like, who's buying a bag of lemons?
I bought the big bag of lemons.
Take your shirt outside and rub it in sand.
They say place an old sponge inside of the bag, secure it with a zip tie.
Sorry, Mike, what are you doing with all these lemons?
We make like lemon pastas and whatnot, man.
All right. Oh,
you know what? No, okay. Honestly, cutie bag, right?
Yeah, all cutie right. bag, same
now
thing.
That I would all have.
Right, okay.
Like, we make our own Caesar dressing and whatnot and take some lemon juice.
All right.
Hey, you guys are working, man.
You like bet, that. Dude. Hey, we cook in this household.
I make my own, too. Paul Newman puts it in a bottle for you. Open it up.
Thanks, Paul.
Thanks, Paul.
Using your dishwasher to dry hand wash dishes. It says skip the dish rack. It takes up too much precious container counter space, rather, and use your dishwasher's empty racks to dry out your hand wash dishes. Your dishwasher will hold more than a dish rack, so you can clean a sink full of hand-wash-only dishes in no time. So basically, if you actually do the rest of running the dishwasher, which is emptying the damn thing, then when you have all these hand-wash dishes, you don't run it in the dishwasher, you just let them drip dry in there.
Right.
I feel like if I'm at the point where I'm not letting them sit on my counter, like I might as well just dry them off.
Exactly.
Or I'm just putting them there.
If I'm putting them in the dishwasher, I'm starting the dishwasher.
I'm with Miles, yeah.
It's because you're stoned and you're not thinking that you're just
like,
letting them dry.
Why do I hand wash? It just feels dirty.
I'll just leave
I hand washed them. Now I'm putting them in there?
I'll just leave these clothes in the washing machine and let them dry in there.
Oh, God. They say keep a dish brush in your shower. Says, the secret to a clean shower is cleaning it on a regular basis. And the secret to cleaning your shower on a regular basis? Having a soap-loaded dish brush ready in your shower cabinet.
I think the secret is having scrubbing bubbles.
Yeah, right? Just spray it down. You don't need to go through all this trouble.
Mr. Clean Magic Eraser. Hey, line.
Have you guys ever taken a moment to wash something while you're in the shower? You see a little spot on there, so you splash some water on
it. Oh, absolutely.
Oh, yeah, of course. Yeah.
And then get to myself, but yes. I've been staring at the stain for like a week and a half. Like, I'm going to go ahead and deal with that.
I always end up...
Not when you say it, I would say the bulk of it. Sometimes it's like, get the little squeegee thing out. Like, well, I'm in here.
Yeah, right. Let me just take care of this. I end up unclogging the doggone drain when I'm showering.
I have to, because everyone else in my hair home has hair.
Yeah, right. And they never fix it.
No.
And the thing is that I always do the same thing. For like a month straight, I look at that like, doggone it, I got to get some Drano or a hook or something like that to get that stuff out.
But once you do get that big piece out, you feel so good.
Yes, sir.
It's like 9 inches just dripping of crap.
Yeah, God, just pull that rat out of there.
Yeah, that
I do it every time I get in.
Because
I don't want to get to that point.
Right.
And my daughter, I guess she's shedding maybe. I mean, she has a long curly hair, but I'm like, my God, are you just cutting your hair and stuffing it in the drain?
I just basically wait until I'm wading in the water. And then I'm like, all right, screw it. I undo the thing.
I'm ankle deep.
Start ripping stuff out. And you think, yes. Let's see. Keeping some chalk in your kitchen. Chalk is super absorbent, which makes it an excellent stain stick. Remove any excess food and oil from the soiled garment with a clean paper towel and cover up the entire spot with chalk.
Really?
And before you toss your oil-stained item in the laundry, rub the spot with a little stain remover or laundry detergent, wash it in hot water, and your oily spot should be gone.
I wish I had known that. We actually have chalk in the kitchen because we have a blackboard in there, so you write like notes, grocery list, whatever, but I never thought to use it on a grease stain.
Same.
And it never crossed my mind.
Grease stains are hard to get out, so I'm a little bit skeptical, but you know what? I'd be willing to give it a shot. They say a weird but effective way to clean your bathroom. Again, these are the most brilliant cleaning hacks. Pam cooking spray, apparently. Not only will it remove soap scum from your tub, but it can also shine your faucets, clean your glass surfaces, and even stop your bathroom door from squeaking.
Same thing with WD-40.
Ooh. Right. It's just oil.
I got to get some WD-40. Wait, yeah. My bathroom door squeaks so
loud.
But
if they're that close, maybe you shouldn't be cooking with Pam.
I'm sure it's like two ingredients.
WD-40 and Pam do the same thing.
Pretty much.
Really?
Oh, my God. How long is it like cook some pancakes? We don't have any Pam. Honey, grab the WD-40.
Jesus.
You can polish a stainless steel sink with flour. If you have a stainless steel sink, the single best thing that you can do for it is polish it with flour. Wash and dry the sink, sprinkle the whole thing with flour, and then you get to buffing. You'll be surprised at how sparkly the metal gets. Now, I don't know what the after effects are of all this.
Yeah.
You might just have a bunch of putty in your doggone sink.
That's the thing. Yeah, what's in my drain?
Right. Let's see here. They say this tip was a game changer for one of our writers. The idea is simple. Set a timer and work until the buzzer goes off. You may finish the dishes early, and at the very least, you'll know exactly how long you have to subject yourself to some mundane task. So basically, your cleaning hack is setting a specified time for how long you're going to clean. Sometimes cleaning can just be a daunting thing that takes forever.
Sure.
Don't make it take forever. As soon as the timer goes off, grab yourself a beer, sit down.
Mm-hmm. I agree.
Yeah, that's fair.
I agree with that.
Even just taking a break just to chill out for a minute.
Exactly. The laundry basket method. If you've got a lot of piles of little piles of clutter everywhere, a laundry basket is a brilliant way to consolidate all the things that are out of place. If you're in a hurry, just stash the laundry basket out of sight, and you've got time, walk around with the laundry basket and put all the things back where they belong.
That makes sense. We got a couple of big with Rubbermaid bins and all that kind of crap.
You bet.
I don't know what's in there. Like, nothing of mine goes in there. But if I kind of peek, I'm like, kid stuff, wife stuff. No idea what it is, but it's not clutter. Mm-hmm.
Putting a cotton ball in your trash can. So this is actually an aromatic thing. So this says garbage stinks. It's a fact of life. But here's the trick to make it a little less smelly, or rather smelly in a good way. Take a cotton ball, soak it in essential oil, and then drop it in the bin.
Oh, well.
Underneath the liner or the bag, it's an easy and an inexpensive odor fighter that helps keep your trash from getting too pungent.
Dryer sheets play a good role, too.
That's a fact.
Just between your bag and actual trash can.
Dude, I swear by having one of the little air fresheners by the door.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. You bet, dude. 100%. And then this is the final brilliant cleaning hack of all time. It's not exactly brilliant. But they cut a corner off your sponge. He says, you know that sponge that you use to clean the dishes with, and then the other sponge that you use to wipe down, like, the walls and stuff like that you don't really want to touch your dishes? Keep track of which one is which with a smart little trick of just cutting the corner off of one sponge. Or you can do what I do and just use them with different colored Scotch pads.
There you go. And that goes a long way, too.
Parents in the Netherlands have a rite of passage known as droping. And I'll tell you all about it at 5:50.
Thank you, sir. Headlines are coming up at 5:50. In the meantime, let's get a contestant online for Profile This at 206-803-ROCK. All right, have we made it to Dragon Time?
What's up? It's your boy, The Ted Smith from The Men's Room. And did you know I have a podcast? Well, I do. The Podcast. New episodes uploaded every Wednesday on the Odyssey app.
This episode is brought to you by Progressive Insurance. Whether you love true crime or comedy, celebrity interviews or news, you call the shots on what's in your podcast queue. And guess what? Now you can call them on your auto insurance too with the Name Your Price tool from Progressive. It works just the way it sounds. You tell Progressive how much you want to pay for car insurance, and they'll show you coverage options that fit your budget. Get your quote today at progressive.com to join the over 28 million drivers who trust Progressive. Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and Affiliates. Price and coverage match limited by state law.
You're working from home. You settle in with a cup of coffee, ready to get the day started. Before you look at that to-do list, turn on your favorite Odyssey sports station on your smart speaker. We'll keep you company and bring you the latest updates from your teams while you tackle your inbox or get ready for another meeting that probably could have been an email. Power through the workday with the entertaining sports coverage you love from the local voices you trust. Just ask your smart speaker to play your favorite station.
This episode is brought to you by Progressive Insurance. Whether you love true crime or comedy, celebrity interviews or news, you call the shots on what's in your podcast queue. And guess what? Now you can call them on your auto insurance too with the Name Your Price tool from Progressive. It works just the way it sounds. You tell Progressive how much you want to pay for car insurance, and they'll show you coverage options that fit your budget. Get your quote today at progressive.com to join the over 28 million drivers who trust Progressive. Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and Affiliates. Price and coverage match limited by state law.
You're working from home. You settle in with a cup of coffee, ready to get the day started. Before you look at that to-do list, turn on your favorite Odyssey sports station on your smart speaker. We'll keep you company and bring you the latest updates from your teams while you tackle your inbox or get ready for another meeting that probably could have been an email. Power through the workday with the entertaining sports coverage you love from the local voices you trust. Just ask your smart speaker to play your favorite station.
Hey, anyone know what channel the game's on?
We know. Download the Sports on What app today and always know how to watch the game. Satellite, cable, or streaming. Sports on What knows the channel the game is on, and you can too. Subscribe today to start your 7-day free trial. Sports on What. We know.
All right, have we made it to Dragon Time?
Somebody out there deserves to be recognized. And the men's room knows just who it is. So to you, we say, bottoms up, sailor. You're the toast of our shot of the day.
Drink time it is, and as usual, we head to the drink desk. And Steve, a thrill hill to find out who we're toasting.
Yes, indeed. And today, we toast 25-year-old Mitchell Deslatte of Baton Rouge, Louisiana. Now, I'm not sure where he was driving to, but he was tired.
and he didn't want to be behind the wheel anymore, so he pulled into a motel on the side of the road. He walked in, asked the clerk for a room. Now, the clerk, however, not a clerk. He was the state trooper.
Uh-oh.
Immediately, Mitchell asked if everything was okay at the motel. The trooper explained, everything's fine because you're not at a motel. You pulled into the state trooper station. And that's when Mitchell was arrested and charged with driving while intoxicated.
Jesus.
Yeah, he was hammered, had no idea, asked for a room, and they're like, this is too easy.
We have one for you.
He did get a room, so there's
Yeah,
that.
No doubt, right?
Yeah. So we pour this booze, and we drink this booze, because we think it's yummy.
Yummy!
So over the tongue and down the throat to party in our tummies.
Down the hola, bitola!
The Men's Room presents... Profile This.
And Stephen Throwhill, could you please start everyone now? Profile This is played.
Oh, I sure can, Miles. It's a simple game where we share with you a real-life news story, something that happened right here on planet Earth. And as you listen to the story, based on the stereotypes you believe to be true of people and the decisions that people make, we'll ask you what it is you think makes the story a story. All right, our caller Gary has dropped off the line because Gary's a rat bastard. So... Sorry, dear. So you gentlemen will be competing, and today you have three categories to choose from. We have the wonderful world of drugs. We have bite me. In other words, what did someone find in their food? And finally, interior decorating, where you guess the foreign object that ended up on the inside of someone.
The classics.
Let's go interior decorating.
All right. Miles picks butt stuff. They say a man ended up needing something yanked out of his rectum after shoving it in there to treat his hemorrhoids. That's according to him. The 51-year-old man rushed to the hospital early hours of the morning, confessing to medics that he, in fact, put the object inside his anus. And the company of his wife, he stated that he pushed it in 2 days before to treat his hemorrhoids. But surgeons tasked with retrieving the object found no evidence of the hemorrhoids. Let that sink in. The man then revealed that he tried to extract the foreign body using a screwdriver and a spoon. Initial attempts to remove it at the hospital also proved unsuccessful.
Holy cow.
The man, who was not identified, he stayed overnight at the hospital, allowing the team to work out a plan of attack. Asked to lay flat on his back with his legs in the air, surgeons armed with, quote, sufficient lubrication, tried to pull the object out manually. However, they failed because the object was, quote, wider than the pelvic outlet.
Oh.
Left with no other option, the man's stomach had to be cut into to allow the team to get closer to the object, but they even failed at that. Surgeons then decided to, quote, carefully cut the object into three smaller pieces, use an electric drill, insert it through his, quote, dilated anus. Side note, dilated anus, that's my wife's pet name for me.
Oh, no.
Hey, dilated anus, wanna... get hot and heavy later?
I saw them once at Lollapalooza.
Oh, dilated anus? Yeah, fantastic.
Crushed. Did they use like one of those little eye-opener things like in the horror movie?
I truly do not know.
Daytime sets. He couldn't tell how dilated it was.
This is when you don't want to say, I'm a doctor on the plane. Anyway, and now the question is, what did this dude shove up his butt to treat the hemorrhoids that he didn't have? Was it a Barbie doll head? Was it a toothbrush? Was it a tennis ball or a lotion bottle? So a Barbie doll head, toothbrush, tennis ball, or lotion bottle. I'm treating my hemorrhoids. Sir, you don't have hemorrhoids.
So here's my thought process. Oh, I think he managed to work a tennis ball in there, but its material is a little too grippy. So that's why it was probably difficult to go in, but it sure as hell was difficult to come on out. And that's something that I think they could also cut into three different pieces. Maybe using a spoon and a drill to try to get it out. It all makes sense to me that this is a tennis ball.
A tennis ball.
Okay.
I think, right, you said a toothbrush?
Yeah, Barbie doll head, toothbrush, tennis ball, and a lotion bottle.
I think toothbrush, most of us have one that vibrates at some point. He doesn't have hemorrhoids. That was the excuse. He put a toothbrush up there trying to get some pleasure.
Relief.
I'm going to go with the motion lotion.
Oh, God.
What did he get stuck up there in the backside? Was it a Barbie doll head, a toothbrush, a tennis ball, or a lotion bottle? We'll find out next.
That was a tease.
This episode is brought to you by Progressive Insurance. Whether you love true crime or comedy, celebrity interviews or news, you call the shots on what's in your podcast queue. And guess what? Now you can call them on your auto insurance too with the Name Your Price tool from Progressive. It works just the way it sounds. You tell Progressive how much you want to pay for car insurance, and they'll show you coverage options that fit your budget. Get your quote today at Progressive.com to join the over 28 million drivers who trust Progressive. Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and Affiliates. Price and coverage match limited by state law.
You're working from home. You settle in with a cup of coffee, ready to get the day started. Before you look at that to-do list, turn on your favorite Odyssey sports station on your smart speaker. We'll keep you company and bring you the latest updates from your teams while you tackle your inbox or get ready for another meeting that probably could have been an email. Power through the workday with the entertaining sports coverage you love from the local voices you trust. Just ask your smart speaker to play your favorite station.
99.9 KISW. We return to the men's room with Miles and Thrill.
Categories: interior decorating on profile. This man had to get something removed from his backside. He was trying to take care of hemorrhoids, which apparently he did not have. Doctors tried two or three different methods.
Or his method worked miraculously.
To extract this thing. Eventually, they did get it out after they basically put a drill in there and ripped it into three different pieces. They could pull it out individually. Or piece by piece. Question is, what was stuck? Was it a Barbie doll head, a toothbrush, a tennis ball, or a lotion bottle?
And gentlemen, that is a question that I pose to you. Let us start with D. Ted Smith. You believe that he put a toothbrush in his dilated anus?
I did.
Specifically, the vibrating kind that explains itself. That's not what was in his dilated anus.
Classic.
Miles Montgomery, you went with the motion lotion.
I did. Nope.
Yep. Also, not the motion lotion that leaves our very own Mike Hawk.
Show me tennis ball.
It is a tennis ball, bro.
No, it's for my hemorrhoids.
How?
Right.
Right. I know you can squeeze them down a bit, but it retakes its shape, which proved to be the problem.
I'm just. Have you never used a tennis ball to get like a knot out of your shoulder or something like that?
Sure.
It's a very good massaging technique, yes. And it does help with a lot of common ailments.
I just never put it in my anus.
Meanwhile, yeah. This dog's like, where's my ball?
Yeah. Oh, God.
This dog's probably thinks it's even better.
Now for all TV news all the time, it is time for TV Time with Ted.
And now, because your pathetic life is confined to countless hours in front of a talking box, the Men's Room presents TV Time with Ted.
All right, your choices today. You got the Jimmys.
Fallon and Kibble.
You got Seth Meyers. Bill Maher. Weekend Update. Colbert. Or Ted Smith.
Is it Ted or is it Late Night?
It's right there in the title. These guys have teams of talented writers helping come up with their monologues each and every night. It is up to you to determine, is this an actual late night joke and from whom? Or could it be a the Ted Smith original?
Netflix is being criticized for implying that the Menendez brothers were incestuous in a new documentary. Said the brothers, "We're just glad our parents aren't around to see this."
Ted?
SNL.
Yes, SNL.
A new Netflix show about convicted murderers Eric and Lau Menendez is being criticized for implying the brothers had an incestuous relationship. Said the brothers, "We're just glad our parents aren't around to see this."
Former President Trump is now selling gold watches, with some going up to $100,000, which leaves only one statement left. Your move, Democrats.
Myers.
Yeah, I'll say so.
Smith. Does Kamala even have a watch? An attorney for Sean Diddy Combs says that his client wants to testify, saying, "I don't know that I can keep him off the stand because you can't hold a guy back wearing all that oil."
SNL?
Fallon.
Weekend Update.
An attorney for Diddy said that his client wants to testify at his trial, saying, "I don't know that I can keep him off the stand because you can't hold a guy back wearing all that baby oil."
Someone has to explain to me the business model of the American drugstore. We'll sell drugs, but also alcohol, sweatpants, Halloween crap, and overpriced USB cords. We only hire one employee to manage it all, who has to sell ice cream and take the passport photos.
Bill Maher.
Yeah, I'll say Bill Maher.
Yeah, it's Bill Maher.
Someone has to explain to me the business model of the American drugstore.
We'll sell drugs, but also alcohol, sweatpants, Halloween crap, and overpriced USB cords. And yeah, we'll only hire one employee to manage it all, who also has to serve ice cream and take passport photos.
Sean Combs' defense attorney also argued that his client is not like R. Kelly. But I have to agree, Diddy is nothing like R. Kelly. I mean, R. Kelly songs are good.
Is that SNL?
Yes.
Sean Combs' defense attorney also argued that his client is not like R. Kelly. But I have to agree, it's true. Diddy is nothing like R. Kelly. I mean, R. Kelly's songs are good.
It's funny, I could watch, I always watch Saturday Night Live, usually on Sunday afternoon. That's a lie. Sunday evening.
Yeah.
But I saw that joke last night. I was like, yeah, I'm going to have to read that one.
Oh, yeah. That's a good one.
Yeah. That was probably the highlight of it. Now, the cold opening of SNL this week was pretty good, just because there was a lot of people there that aren't usually there. We knew Maya Rudolph was coming back to play Kamala Harris. Jim Gaffigan popped up to play Tim Waltz, who's running with her, which makes sense because he has kind of a
goofy
Midwestern feel. Andy Samberg was on there to play Kamala's husband, Doug. And then Dana Carvey shuffled out to play Joe Biden. Thurl and I were just talking about this. I've seen a lot of Bidens, right? Like my guy Adam Ray does a pretty good Biden. But Dana Carvey's Biden was...
He crushed it.
Awesome.
He had a hard time keeping it together.
He did. It was hilarious.
He was on fire. You knew it.
Yeah, and like I never even thought about Biden having like a catchphrase. Well, I'm serious, right? It was just like all of a sudden I was like, "God damn, that's good."
Oh yeah, that was real good.
Yeah,
and like he kind of specializes in the presidents too, though.
He does, like but does he really, really? I mean, just the mannerisms and everything else.
Because he did
really,
both the Bushes, didn't he?
Yeah. He's been doing it that long,
right? Did he do Clinton at all?
He didn't do Clinton, but he was Ross Perot, I think, for a while too.
Like he's good at that political one.
He is. I mean, look, Dana Carvey, to me, I'm always shocked he didn't become a bigger star. When you look at like some of the line, and he's had a bunch of movies and stuff, but yeah, and granted, he's probably at his prime SNL when I'm like old enough to finally start seeing some. It's like I always say, I was, as a kid, I couldn't fathom why Church Lady wasn't on every week because I didn't realize that it's like a skit show.
Right.
So it's not always the same thing. But yeah, I'm with you, Mike. I think Dana
at the same time, he's doing Wayne's World. I mean, they had sketches that were just, I mean, that larger than life.
But he never launched. Like, everyone knows him from Wayne's World. You're glad he was in Wayne's World. You loved his character in Wayne's World. And Mike Myers went on to be massive.
I think by the time he got on my radar was when he did that movie, that Master of Disguise movie.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah, he had one good movie, too. I can't remember the name of it, where it's like, I almost want to say he's playing like a, like he's involved in crime, like swindling people out of stuff or whatever. And like comes from like a bad family or whatever. It's kind of like makes you feel good in the end. But like that was a good movie too. But you're right. And credit to Mike Myers. Mike Myers got crazy famous between Shrek and
Austin Powers.
But then he kind of like dipped out too.
But I think with all that Shrek money, I mean, seriously, like Eddie Murphy and Mike Myers, I think they make more money off of residuals from the Shrek movies than they did for anything else they've done. I mean, by leaps and bounds.
And Mike Myers still has one of the most awkward TV moments of all time.
With Kanye West.
I mean, they're on national TV. Kanye West looks at the camera and says, President Bush hates black people. Like,
Mike Myers.
What is Mike Myers supposed to say to that?
You know, in Canada, we love everyone.
Yeah. Right.
Has anyone not had an awkward moment with Kanye West?
You know, that's a good point.
There's Taylor Swift, there's Mike Myers, I mean, you name it. Like, if dude shows up, even if you had a planned interview with him, but it's televised, at some point it's going to get weird. Because he's stupid and weird. And when you put those two things together, it's like, all right.
Well, and much like the Mike Myers situation the other, he just kind of flies in there with whatever's on his head.
I'm not sure if they said, hey, we got a Kanye interview. Like, do we want to do it?
No.
I mean, the exposure would be good. But
can we pre-record it?
Yeah, who knows what he's going to say?
You know what? I would do it because I have very little respect for the man, but I find him entertaining. Because I do think he's, aside from being weird, I also think he's very, very stupid. So I do think there's some entertainment value. That it's like talking to Vince Neil. Mm-hmm. Not particularly weird, but it's like you're a douchebag, but you're also kind of stupid.
Yeah. And he does create good art, right? Like, I loved his first few albums.
Sure.
Like, to his credit, I think those Yeezys are ugly, but Mayhem, they sold. People love them.
Yeah.
He dresses like a Jawa.
Yeah, no. I mean, you know what you're getting if you're going to interview the guy. You can't act surprised, right? Like, the brother came in dressed like a Jawa on, like, a unicycle.
Yeah, man.
Like, what did you
up,
think was going to happen?
He's, like, wearing red eyes. You're like, oh, look, it's a Jawa.
Yeah. I was like, come on.
Such an easy Halloween costume. It's right there for him.
Now he's going to dress as a sexy nun.
Oh, no. Who knows? But, yeah. Going back to SNL, it was very good to see Dana Carvey on there.
Yeah.
And I feel like it's good to bring all those people back, this and that. And look, frankly, after November, either way, they're not going to hear too much from Joe Biden. So, like, let's use Dana Carvey in that impression while we can.
Hell yeah.
Right. How are we doing there, Mike?
Oh, yeah, we're doing good.
All right. Let's see. The Rock, everybody knows Hot Ones, right? You go on there, you eat chicken wings and this and that. So they were, each one gets hotter and hotter.
That's the one where Halle Berry dominated, right? Was she the one who just went in there and just
Yeah,
no
she
problem?
Just didn't flinch.
Okay, okay.
Really?
So Sean Evans says he's
been too crazy to feel heat.
He's been trying to get The Rock on the show for years. He said they got close, and then The Rock came back. One time I got a note back that was like, would you be willing to do, instead of wings, grilled salmon strips? And in my head, I was like, that has to come from his mouth. He says, it's the closest we've gotten, and it fell through.
I've seen his cheat days. That's ridiculous. This is one thing. You're having a couple chicken wings. It ain't going to kill you.
No, I don't think he's in the heat.
The Rock,
The Rock does not strike me.
But he's saying,
he was still going to do the heat.
Yes, but just on salmon strips instead of chicken wings.
But the Rock is fine with hot sauce, but he doesn't do it on wings. The Rock likes salmon strips.
I was going to say, those cheat days, I think, are like 4 a year.
Okay.
Right. I mean, that guy is super strict.
Yeah.
I'm with you, though. It doesn't seem that crazy to have 8 chicken wings. But hey, look, I am not The Rock. All right, that guy's in a different sphere.
Just suck it up and have the doggone 8 wings.
What's going to happen to you, chicken wings?
Right. Is 8 it really going to throw you up? You're on steroids as is, man. Is it really going to throw you off that much?
Next time we see him, he has a pot belly, Caesar ring.
Well, seriously, man.
Like, oh, damn, those rings.
He already doesn't have hair. Where's the Caesar ring coming from?
That's why he doesn't want any chicken.
He just glued it on.
Some football from the weekend. Obviously, Friday night, went home, watched the Husky game at Rutgers. It is rare you see a team just have 200 more yards or whatever it was. They just dominated Rutgers, but had terrible penalties, had some bad mistakes, and they lose that game. I will say this. Washington was very frustrating to watch just because of the, coaching. I mean, to me, that part of that is just coaching, right?
Yes.
You got guys running on the field to celebrate too early, false starts, this and that. But with that said, the Husky program does have a ton of talent. That is a brand new coaching staff. So, I mean, I would think they'll get that ship, kind of right it.
I think they will. They will.
And credit to Rutgers. What's his name's back there? Greg Schiano, right? So, they're playing hard again. I did laugh a little bit in the post game. Now, keep in mind, I am a University of Maryland fan from the beginning. So we joined with Rutgers, the Big Ten. So it was a little funny watching the postgame stuff when they were like, well, hey, it's a Big Ten opponent. I was like, yeah, it's Rutgers.
Right.
Like, I mean, it is. They've been in there for a while.
They're the Big East.
Right. But I get it. They are. That was the first road game. And credit to them. They had that place rocking and rolling, man.
Sure,
man. It was sold out. It was a blackout.
All due respect to that program. This has been 30-some years ago. But, I mean, it was a bye week for us. It was a bye week to play Rutgers. It was like,
Rutgers.
I mean,
nobody cared.
Sometimes they gave us Monday off, which they never did. Like, we just watched game film on Tuesday. Then they jog through. It's Rutgers. It's like playing Temple.
Right.
You know?
Yeah. I was going to say, of course, Maryland let me down. Saturday afternoon, man, shout out to Alabama and Georgia. That game, I wasn't even watching it. And then I turned it on. I was like, oh, it's still on. Georgia storms all the way back.
Man.
What, 2 plays? Alabama's like, nah, we're Alabama. And hey, credit to DeBoer. He's still doing it down there. He just doesn't lose big games. Whether he was at his first school or at Washington, like, I don't know what that guy's doing. He's a
just the national title.
Yeah, well, that's true. That's true. But I mean, that guy is a hell of a coach. He's getting it done.
Yeah, I watched the first 3 quarters. And my son said, well, the score is a big enough deficit. Can we watch Avengers Endgame? I'm like, sure. Then I watched SportsCenter after the Avengers. Goddamn, dude! We just missed one of the most amazing fourth quarters.
I'm telling you, I hadn't seen hardly any of it. And then I was just like, well, I'll just see if it's still going on. Because I was like, I'll see what the Cougs are up to. And then I was like, holy yes, this is a good game.
Yeah, I watched most of it.
Big thing for you tonight.
What's going on?
I don't know, man. Another goddamn blackout. I'm worried about our Seahawks, Mike. But Monday Night Football, they're in Detroit. Detroit's wearing these black uniforms. It's going to be loud and ruckus. But the Seahawks, traditionally,
do pretty well on a Monday night.
Let's go, baby.
So we'll see what happens, but I know everybody's fired up. People, I wonder if anybody can even hear my voice right now.
No one is listening. No one is listening to us.
Right? Anyhow, Monday Night Football, Seahawks and Lions. Go Hawks!
All right, thank you, Tim. We appreciate it. You're listening to The Men's Room.
The Men's Room returns with Miles and Thrill. Now, let's see what's happening in the real world.
All right, here we go. Apparently in the Netherlands, they blindfold their kids and drop them off in the woods for the night. Meanwhile, if you're a zookeeper for lions, turns out you might not be all right. In Vermont, a tour bus gets stuck on a curvy mountain road. A model is catching heat for the sweater puppy she showed. And in Utah, Joseph Smith is turned into an Egyptian space monument. It's time for headlines.
Now, it's time to hit the head. Lines. Here's Mike Hawk.
At our top story, we go to the Netherlands, where their parenting style is just a little bit different from ours. There are several opportunities for kids in the country to take part in different camps, all with their own specific genres. You know, there's space camp, there's band camp, there's scout camp, all this stuff, right? Mm-hmm. But most take part in a beloved tradition known as droping. The kids are blindfolded, whisked away into the woods, and dropped in the middle of nowhere, tasked with finding their way out and back home.
What's the success rate on this?
That's the key.
That's the real question here.
There's actually several variables that come with this kind of ritual. Kids never know if they're by themselves or how many are in their group. Some groups are given a single flashlight and a map. Plenty have been dropped well after dark, but this task is designed to increase self-reliance within the kids, who sometimes have an adult within proximity to keep them from getting into too much trouble, but they never actually make any real contact.
Sure.
There was actually one such adult that told the media that he allowed them to walk in a circle for 5 hours until they finally figured out for themselves that they were about 650 feet from where they needed to be.
Okay.
Which, I mean...
If you have, you know, that kind of supervision going on, not that the kids know, I'm like, cool.
Right, well,
good.
And Miles and I both did the Order of the Arrow thing. His was a little bit more grueling than mine, where it was kind of the same vein where you are your own person out there. There's adults there to keep you from dying out
there.
Sure. But basically just that. You make your own food. You make your own fire. You make your own shelter. You find your own way out. It's up to you.
The key is to, once you establish a place to stay, to not leave that location if you don't have to. Because
absolutely.
You can't see at night. There's cliffs right. Where we lived. I mean, you could just walk off the end of a mountain.
Sure.
So they're basically like, once you find shelter, man, wait till the daylight comes out so you see where you are.
Exactly.
You'll know some topography. You'll be able to kind of figure out how to get out.
Right. Right. Just keep yourself dry and warm for the night. Yeah. And then figure it out in the morning.
Or be cold and wet, but it's up to you.
There you go. There you go. And you know what? I could drove on and on and on about all the bad stuff that's going on right now, but...
Thankfully, there's good news.
I'm just going to skip it all here because it's been a long time coming, and I've got some great personal news here, gentlemen. I'm going to harken all the way back to 2020 to bring the room down here just a little bit. Since the pandemic, my wife and I have moved 4 times in 4 years. 4 times in 4 years that we've put our life into boxes for one reason or another. The last two happening because the houses that we've rented were reclaimed from out from underneath us and through no fault of their own. You know, the house that we got last first, the relationship broke up. He's a great dude. I'm still in contact with him. We talk all the time. And he needed the place back. His relationship fell through and he needed the house back. The place after that. The guy rented it forever, and it was his time to sell it. He and his wife were pregnant, and so they were wanting to just rid themselves from being landlords, and they sold it out from underneath us. But that puts us out yet again. So this last time that we got the news that the place that we call home was being sold, I was put into contact with a wonderful human being, thank you to our own Ted Smith, who bridged that gap. And in the months that followed, a lot of phone calls were made, a lot of stress was taken on, a lot of help was given, so that my wife and I could officially... end this string of wondering if we were going to be under the same roof for the next year, and I am happy to announce that she and I have officially bought and moved in a house together.
All right. Well, it's actually a shed.
There you go.
It's a work shed.
It's a work shed,
it's
right?
A work shed.
And the people whose property is on don't know they're staying there.
Tiny home. Tiny home.
We got to trailer it in there. No, we officially have bought our own spot out there in Tacoma. I am stoked to no longer have to wonder if I'm going to, you know... I kept boxes, you know, first in the attic and then in the basement of these last two places that we were at because I just, and by the end of the year, I don't know if we're staying there anymore.
Why unpack it?
I am ready to burn all those boxes, man. I am done with it all, and I've got a lot of thank yous to make. First off, to Chad from CCH Inspections, who came over and did a very thorough investigation of the place and had a very detailed report of it when he came back.
But they do an amazing job.
They give you
a booklet, based on everything about your house.
Absolutely, and he did just that, and he got in depth with it. And he was even, I wasn't able to be there for a whole lot of the time because we had, I think we had our world tour up there at Mike's,
So I had to take off a little while into it. But he was showing me the house, and he was telling me all these different things that I did not even know about it. And so he was very in-depth. Again, Chad from CCH Inspections, recommend him. He's fantastic.
You go, $500, and then you go like, this is going to save me money down the road.
No kidding. Todd Davidson and Angela from U Mortgage for putting the loan together, getting in touch with the right people. They took all of that on their shoulders. He had a short interview with me and my wife, figured out what we could get done, and then he took it there and took the rest. There was a handful of things. There was a lot of things that they needed from me and my wife.
It's amazing.
To filter on over there, but then they handled all the busy work that was over there. He kept it detailed. He kept me up to date on everything that was going on there. Actually had me go through
a pain in the ass.
Horribly
the
so.
Process, I mean, just like you said, the information they need from you, it's almost like, do you need stem cells? My
right.
God, man.
And even put me through a first-time homebuyer's course, which seems tedious.
Yeah.
And it was about a three-hour course to get through it all. But the amount that I learned actually increased my confidence in what I was doing. Because buying a house is scary as hell.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's a lot that you're putting down there. And that actually really, really helped me with my confidence level. So Todd Davidson, Angela, U Mortgage, highly recommend them. If you want to know how to get in touch with them, shoot me an email. I would definitely do that. Josh and his crew, Jesse and Johnny from New Horizons Moving, who moved me on Saturday. I got up at like 6 o'clock in the morning, started doing a handful of little runovers to the house. They showed up at 9 a.m., great crew. They were fun. They were funny. They were chatting with me back and forth. They took great care of all my stuff.
Also, never mess with a mover.
No.
They can throw a couch on their back, man. You don't want to get into a bar fight.
No
with one
kidding,
of those guys,
dude.
Man.
And they made it look easy. I'm like, dude.
That's why they're scary.
Yes.
They don't grunt like we do.
Yeah.
Right? They bring that truck over and it's like, I don't know, man. I got a lot of stuff. Is it all? Yes, it is all going to fit. We barely made a dent in that doggone truck. And they heaved that stuff upstairs and they broke their backs for me. I appreciate the living hell out of them. Josh and his crew from New Horizons Moving. Again, I'd recommend him every day of the week. But the biggest thank you that I got to give, besides to my grandmother and my dad who helped me out to get this done, is Katie Roth and Joe Butler of Spruce Home Group. If you want to get in touch with them, please, please, please let me know. I want to get you guys in good hands. These two took my wife and I by the hand, sat down, we had drinks several times. They are wonderful people, great people. Loved getting to know them throughout this process. I had actually been out to drinks with Joe once before. And that's kind of how this gap got bridged here, thanks to Ted. And they took care of everything. Every problem that I had, every question that I had, any concern that I had, they were there at a moment's notice to help me out. So if you're looking to buy, if you're on the fence, let me know. I'll put you into touch with them. They are wonderful people, and I highly recommend them if that's what you're looking to do. So I'm done.
Oh, congrats,
I'm finally
man.
That is huge. Out, man.
That is awesome, bro.
And now...
Now you can hate being a homeowner.
That's right. Yeah. Men's Room Sports. The Mariners ended their season over the weekend by sending the Oakland A's into history books with a sweeping loss here in Seattle. They swept them over the weekend. They end on a high note before looking to the next season. Well done, boys. We'll see you in 2025. Sports on the night. The Kraken preseason continues tonight at 6 over on Kong. There's Monday Night Football currently underway on ESPN as Tennessee and Miami go toe-to-toe.
And we know that's the game you're going to watch.
Yeah, exactly. Hold on, guys, man. Who are you got?
That's
Miami,
right.
Miami, Tennessee.
Oh, yeah. And your Seattle Seahawks going to Detroit to take on the Lions in a primetime showdown. That game also underway over on ABC. And if you know that, you're not listening to this. As far as your weather, things have been cooling down to the high 40s tonight leading into tomorrow, where we can expect some morning sunshine with clouds moving in a little bit later. Whoopsie daisy. A little bit later into the evening. And that is it for your headlines. With that, go Hawks! Mike Hawk is out!
Thank you, sir. We'll see you next time. Return to sit and spin 10 other songs from one-hit wonder bands.
Yes,
lovely
indeed.
Jolene's up next.
It's all true, but in the meantime, well, we be all about this bitch. So until next time, please do what you do best. And for Aletha's sake, stay beautiful.
The Men's Room has been taped before a live studio audience. Wardrobe and makeup provided by Mantastic Limited. This has been a presentation of the Men's Room Radio Network.
Oh, man!
A Double Flush production.
What's up? It's your boy, The Ted Smith from The Men's Room. And did you know I have a podcast? Well, I do. The Podcast. New episodes uploaded every Wednesday on the Odyssey app.
This episode is brought to you by Progressive Insurance. Whether you love true crime or comedy, celebrity interviews or news, you call the shots on what's in your podcast queue. And guess what? Now you can call them on your auto insurance too with the Name Your Price tool from Progressive. It works just the way it sounds. You tell Progressive how much you want to pay for car insurance, and they'll show you coverage options that fit your budget. Get your quote today at progressive.com to join the over 28 million drivers who trust Progressive. Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and Affiliates. Price and coverage match limited by state law.
You're working from home. You settle in with a cup of coffee, ready to get the day started. Before you look at that to-do list, turn on your favorite Odyssey sports station on your smart speaker. We'll keep you company and bring you the latest updates from your teams while you tackle your inbox or get ready for another meeting that probably could have been an email. Power through the workday with the entertaining sports coverage you love from the local voices you trust. Just ask your smart speaker to play your favorite station.